long from Yankee Stadium. We head west now. Join Reese Davis, Jesse Palmer, and David Potter.
You're just joining us on ESPN. Welcome to the National University Holiday Bowl and Amir Abdullah's final appearance in a Nebraska uniform as he carries it up to the 50-yard line. Just moments ago, USC freshman Adoree Jackson took a kickoff back 98 yards for a touchdown. He flipped into the end zone, cost him 15 and gave the Huskers good field position. 7-3 game. As Tommy Armstrong Jr., the quarterback, keeps it. There's a flag. Flies on the play. Reese Davis, Jesse Palmer, David Pollitt, Samantha Ponder. Glad to have you with us after a full day, a football extravaganza bowl style. Is Randy Crystal, our referee.
Offside, defense, number 90, 5-yard penalty.
That's Claude Pallone, who is caught lining up in the neutral zone. USC is a little thin on the defensive front. Antoine Woods, their fine junior nose guard, was injured in practice, a pectoral muscle injury. He's out of there. Greg Townsend is also out, so it's a really thin group for the Trojans, who have 51 recruited scholarship players available. Quick pass out to Kenny Bell. Kenny Bell has a first down. He's inside the 35-yard line before he's knocked down. Tua Cravens on the stop. And if you're just joining us on ESPN after that pinstripe bowl thriller, here is the lone touchdown courtesy of the USC freshman Adoree Jackson.
It's a great play by two true freshmen. Juju Smith, the other returner, sets up a key block, and then Adoree Jackson takes it in for his second kick return touchdown of the year.
On the flat to Seethan Carter, and the big tight end gets inside the 20 to about the 15. That's his fifth catch of the season.
And Nebraska's had success early in this game running the football, and that's going to open up play action pass opportunities. And I like the call there by offensive coordinator Tim Beck throwing it on first down.
Armstrong has hit four of his first six. Abdullah, not much running room in the middle against that Trojan defense.
This is where USC's been so good all year, guys, in the red zone on defense. Only 53% of the time, they're allowing opponents to score touchdowns when they make it into this area of the field. They force field goals. They don't give up sevens. They're going to have to play well right here.
Sue Cravens, you'll see him a little bit of everywhere. Number 21.
Also the spot on the field where Armstrong can use his legs to be a pain in the side of USC's defense, too.
Armstrong ran for more than 660 yards this year, but it's Abdullah doing more of the work, and Amir getting inside the 10. It'll be third down and short.
But that's the point, though. You got Armstrong who gets in the shotgun, who sticks it in the belly of Abdullah, who's a great runner. By the way, between the tackles, he might be small, but he's great between the tackles, and Armstrong's a great runner himself, a better runner than a thrower. So they stress you outside and they stress you inside.
Throw. Here it comes. Throwback. Wide open guy. It's big Alex Lewis, and it goes in for the touchdown. Now, Lewis is a tackle by trade, as you know, from the number 71 on his back. We make sure Nebraska got the formation right.
No, he's not eligible, but I thought it was a backward pass.
Yeah.
So I think that should count as a touchdown.
As long as it's backward, it's okay. Let's see if it is.
Looks right on the line. Love fat guy touchdowns.
I love bowl games because you see trick plays just like that.
Because what are you going to do? Well, we also talked to Coach yesterday. What are you going to do, fire me again?
The staff is, as you know, coaching their final game before Mike Riley takes over. You see Randy Crystal, the referee, and his crew, and that's what they're discussing. I would imagine it's whether it was a backward pass.
An ineligible receiver caught a forward pass. It'll be a 5-yard penalty. Third down.
All right, he throws it right at the 15-yard line. Catches it on the 14th.
That's really close.
Okay, Dave Kataya is in the booth with us. Dave, from your view of that, was that accurate?
The only time 71 is eligible is if it is a backward pass. That thing is very, very, very close to being forward and backward. So they talked to the line judge head linesman. They determined it to be forward, therefore illegal.
And when in doubt?
When in doubt, it's forward.
And that's not reviewable either, is it, Dave?
It is actually reviewable, okay. Yes. Yeah.
So is it where he releases it, the football, and throws it, and then it's where it's caught, correct?
It's where he releases it, where it first touches anything. be it the ground, the player, or an official.
So that should be a touchdown then, I think.
Maybe right.
Because he released it on the 15, and you could see the lineman caught it on the 14.
Yeah, his body was certainly further back, but his arm was way out ahead of him. It looked like it came out around the 15.
So I think Lewis should get a 300-pound man touchdown is what should happen.
Okay, they're taking a look at it right now. So let's look now, David.
Right there. There's the ball on the 15-yard line.
Okay.
Now Lewis catches it, and it's clearly thrown, and it catches it on the 14-yard line.
Yeah, with 13 and a half almost. Yeah.
I'm sorry, 16. Yeah. So that's a yard, right? I mean, I'm not great at math, but
this obviously, this angle, it's not right down the line on the 15-yard line.
Now, see, what's fooled the official here, if, in fact, they overturn this, is that where Lewis catches the ball is in front of where Armstrong's body is. But as we saw from the other angle, it appeared that the football, as Tommy had it stretched out, was in front of him. But again, that goes back to Dave's point, number one, about when in doubt, forward pass. And then also the standard that you've heard many times about review
after
and overturning.
After further video review, the play stands as called. Nebraska will not be charged with a timeout.
So Barney Cotton wanted him to look again, but they're not going to charge him with a timeout. And because they said, Dave, the play stands, means not enough video evidence, indisputable, to turn the call around and say it was a legal play.
That's exactly right, and I happen to agree with that. Now, what happened is Nebraska coach probably wanted a challenge, but they buzzed it just before, therefore not charging him with a timeout.
So after all of that, Barney Cotton had a trick play dialed up. And now let's see if Nebraska can score in a conventional method. And another flag flies. Trojans were showing a stunt.
Price did a Cotton impression right there. Did you see that? He was trying to hold it like against Michigan State.
And Jake Cotton, as you probably saw, went viral, fell out of his stance in the Michigan State game earlier this year, trying not to move.
Got the right tackle, too, Matt Finnan. Yeah, 59. He was a backup.
False start. Offense. Number 59. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Sorry, I meant Finnan, but yeah, the same thing that Cotton did in the Michigan State game.
I don't blame him, David, because you got a backup right tackle in the game, and you're facing off against Leonard Williams, who's probably going to be a top five pick in next year's upcoming draft, in an obvious passing situation. It's easy to get antsy.
Let's not forget, too, Mark Pelini, Ryan Reeves, starters on the offensive line for Nebraska, are out of this game. So the Cornhuskers, with some of their usual personnel up front, not available for this one. A little bit of a low snap. Trojans coming after Armstrong, lofting to the end zone, looking for Bell. Kenny Bell, did he get a touchdown, Nebraska?
This is what we talked about, guys. Every game, when you watch the film, number 80 at some point makes an unbelievable acrobatic catch. His athleticism, his eye-hand coordination, his body flexibility and bend is off the charts. That's a tremendous throw by Tommy Armstrong, putting it only where his receiver can make the play. That's a great job stretching out. Great effort by Kenny Bell.
And you want to talk about standing your ground from that other angle? How about our cameraman, Wade Hewitt, down there? Great grab by Bell, who is Nebraska's all-time leader in catches and yards, and he grabs his sixth touchdown of the season. Many of the spectacular variety. Wade getting that high-tech gear together. Oh, no.
I think he said it's broken.
Oh, he's just
cha-ching.
We'll get Wade another camera and might have to get some new undergarments for the USC defensive backs who just got toasted by Kenny Bell. Ring one up for the Cornhuskers, and back and forth we go. Nebraska up by 3.
The 2014 National University Holiday Bowl is brought to you by National University. Keep learning at nu.edu. Lexus. The Lexus December to Remember sales event is here, now through January 5th. And the Venture Card from Capital One. Earn unlimited double miles with no blackout dates.
support of San Diego Big Bay Balloon Parade downtown yesterday. I sort of stumbled upon that yesterday afternoon. I said, what's the big commotion? And all of a sudden, in the distance, I heard the Trojan March song being played in the distance.
And then you were weird.
And then you were body surfing.
Oh, yeah. Miracle that didn't make it on social media, too. And Kenny Bell just made a touchdown grab for the Cornhuskers. A spectacular one on third down to cap off a six-play, 53-yard drive. Haven't seen much of Cody Kessler the last time Nebraska kicked off. Dory Jackson made use of the offense unnecessary with a 98-yard kickoff return, and Nebraska learns quickly they're trying to keep it away from him. Instead, it'll be the other freshman, Juju Smith. And Juju slips a couple of tackles and gets up close to about the 34-yard line. Let's take a look at tonight's Buick Drive recap, and it was quite a drive for the Huskers. They reached into the bag of tricks, trying a backward pass to Alex Lewis that was ruled a forward pass, thus illegal. And then the more conventional method as Kenny Bell brings one up. Tommy Armstrong Jr., 3 for 3, 48 yards in the touchdown. And Kenny giving a shout out to his former coach, Bo Pelini, after scoring the touchdown and giving Nebraska the lead. So not yet halfway through the first quarter, and we had some stuff happen. Fire out and quickly to the tight end Bryce Dixon, yet another of the talented freshmen on this roster for Steve Sarkisian.
I think one thing that's important to watch as this game goes on is USC's offensive line. They're starting three true freshmen and a sophomore, and they're playing against a very athletic Nebraska front that can rush the passer and be physical. How do they hold up in this game?
Buck Allen has the catch. Allen across the 50, and he gets into Nebraska territory, tracked down by Zaire Anderson, but the Trojans are on the move.
Well, this is a bit of a coverage, but Zaire Anderson, 13, is supposed to get outside and cover, but you see he gets picked here by Randy Telford. He doesn't get picked. He just doesn't get wide
He's
outside.
He's playing zone coverage. Everybody else is playing man.
Yeah, he needs to get out there.
And if Kessler puts that in front of Allen, he might still be running.
Contact in the interior.
False start. Offense, number 60. 5 yards, first down.
The freshman, Vianney Talamaival, who is a highly thought of freshman guard, one of the three freshmen that Jesse was talking about starting on the offensive front for USC. And it's one of the reasons the next year, even if Leonard Williams goes as expected, even if Buck Allen goes as expected, he'll be highly ranked in the preseason. Nelson Aguilar could also be headed to the NFL, but there's a ton of talent on this USC roster as Aguilar gets some of the yardage back.
So they run it well, even though they're young up front, but then the playmakers on the outside, that's all Kessler has to do. Just spit it out there real quick, because you got guys that can pick up 4 or 10 or 30.
Aguilar with another catch. Nelson has a first down, and he spins out of bounds. Josh Mitchell there to shut him out of bounds.
It's the perfect play call by USC at the right time. Nebraska is going to bring pressure right here through the middle. They're able to get Cody Kessler outside away from it, throwing on the run. There's an accurate throw to Aguilar.
A dime. It's a perfect throw.
Buster!
Kessler has a lot of experience this year throwing under duress. That young line has had growing pains, dealing with movement at times. George Farmer, Speedster, who's finally starting to blossom. He's dealt with injuries throughout his career, but he had the huge game against Notre Dame. A couple of touchdown catches on deep balls. Makes an early grab here against the Cornhuskers.
Yeah, you're right, Reese. He's really started to emerge these last couple weeks. In this game, if number 8's one-on-one in a man-to-man situation, Cody Kessler's going to take a shot.
How about on the slant, and Farmer drops it. And I was just about to say that Farmer is from the same high school as Robert Woods, Marquise Lee, Adoree Jackson, who we saw a little while ago. And Farmer, coming out of high school, was more highly regarded in some circles than Lee or Woods. The injuries have slowed him down, and he's got tremendous speed, probably the fastest Trojan. A little bit late looking for Telfer. Knocking it away was Josh Mitchell.
It was a heck of a play by Mitchell. He broke on that quick.
You see the windows when throwing against Nebraska are really small. And you see right here, opposing quarterbacks complete 47% of their throws. They play a match zone defense. It's not man-to-man. They don't play in they don't cover space like most normal zone defenses do. They challenge you. They read route combinations, pass them off. it's tough to just to complete throws against this dude.
Andre Hadary from 42 yards out, and that is significant because prior to that field goal attempt, he'd been 0-for-0 between 40 and 49 yards in that little range. Well, he has one now, and it gets us back to even. Night starts to fall in San Diego. Nebraska, USC, tied at 10.
National.
Tonight's aerial coverage from the National University Holiday Bowl is brought to you by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get DirecTV. But first quarter between these two storied programs. Among all-time bowl appearances, only the All-State Sugar Bowl matching Alabama and Ohio State will have more combined bowl appearances than these two put on their resumes, Nebraska and USC. Trojans just got an Andre Hadary field goal to tie it up, and they'll kick it to Amir Abdullah. They're at a 49-yard kickoff return to open the game. Amir slipped just a bit as he crossed the 20 and got up to the 29, and there is a flag down back on the USC end of the field and from where they kicked it anyway.
Offside, kicking team, number 2. 5 yards will be added to the end of the run, first and 10.
We called that on Dory Jackson. They might be watching him after that flip on the kickoff return for a touchdown. Capital One Bowl Mania continues Monday on ESPN. Got three games for you. Texas A&M and West Virginia will get things started in the AutoZone Liberty Bowl. Then the Russell Athletic Bowl, Oklahoma and Clemson. Tigers will be without Deshaun Watson. And then the Advocare V100 Texas Bowl, an old SWC-flavored game between the Razorbacks and the Longhorns. Tommy Armstrong. Wires crossed just a little bit with freshman DeMorne Pearsonell.
Yeah, he wanted Pearsonell to keep running on that play. And Pearsonell, just a true freshman. And a little mix up there with his quarterback. You know, Tommy Armstrong's a phenomenal athlete, guys. He's made plays all year long with his legs. He's going to have to do that. But his accuracy, especially when throws are wide open, he's got to be able to make those as this game goes on. Something he hasn't always been able to do this season.
Terrell Newby's checked in at running back for Nebraska to give Amir Abdullah a break. Be a good time to mention that Monty Cross, a veteran running back, is out with a knee injury for the Huskers. Armstrong taking another shot. Bell's out there and is knocked away at the last second. Adoree Jackson.
And that was a great job running. A lot of cornerbacks, they get beat. You see them, they hesitate. Adoree Jackson, as soon as he got beat, turned and went. Then watch his right hand at the end of the play. He sticks it up right there, right when Bell sticks his hands up. That's when you're a DB, you're supposed to watch the receiver's hands. And as soon as he sticks them up there to go catch it, you stick your hand up right between it. It's a heck of a play by the true freshman.
That is why he was Pac-12 Defensive Freshman of the Year. Third down and 10. Armstrong trying to get it back, and he does. Fires complete, and this time right on the money and on the same wavelength with Pearsonell. But DeMorne gets it into USC territory.
And USC has to do a better job defensively of not letting Armstrong get outside the pocket. Watch Felix, 47 right here on the end. Right here he gets cut down. You got to stay on your feet. You got to stay outside. Armstrong wants to run the football to buy himself some time.
Pickup of 19 on third and 10. And right into the gut of the defender, Gerald Bowman. And he couldn't hang on to it. That ball should have been picked off.
And Leonard Williams, we talked about him a little bit already. But watch the swim move right off the ball. The top of the screen. Look at that. 6'6", 300 pounds. He's quick. He's fast. He's strong.
But again, David, miscommunication by the quarterback and his intended target. That time is tight end Sam Cotton running an out route. That football needs to be thrown out in front. Or the tight end was supposed to curl inside, but Nebraska very lucky that wasn't picked.
That is not picked. Dart to Kenny Bell on second down to get to the 40. It'd be about 3 yards short of the first
down. How about Nebraska, obviously known as a running team, and on this entire drive, every play so far has been a pass. See offensive coordinator Tim Beck right there. This is, again, a down and distance right here for Tommy Armstrong. If nothing's open, use your feet, use your athleticism to go get this first down.
Amir Abdullah.
A
They get it to him on the pass. He did not. And we're looking for Amir on the flat. J.R. Devay was applying the pressure.
Talked about the wide open throws are the ones Tommy Armstrong has to make, and he's having a word there with Abdullah, but there was pressure coming off the outside from Devay, and Armstrong's feet weren't able to get set nonetheless. That's a throw that Armstrong's just got to be able to find a way to negotiate to convert that third down.
Played just over 10 minutes. Would you have thought that Armstrong would already have 13 passes? It might be a product of them with a banged up offensive line having to deal with that USC front. Nebraska coverage teams all over the punt from Sam Foltz. And Joshua Kalu is there to down it. Now, Nebraska, of course, will have Mike Riley take over. The head coach after this game, a shocking hire, not necessarily because Mike's not an excellent coach, he is, just everybody thought he was in for the long haul for good at Oregon State. Got the opportunity at Nebraska, decided to take it, replace Bo Pelini. Mike Riley will join us a little bit later on in our coverage tonight of the National University Holiday Bowl. And we covered the Las Vegas Bowl last year when USC was in this situation a year ago. Steve Sarkisian was in the stadium watching his team play, his future team play, and there were still some bruised feelings among the Trojan players over Ed Orgeron not getting the job on a permanent basis after Lane Kiffin was fired. Cody Kessler has to get out of his end zone and then just get rid of it before the pressure arrived.
To your point, Reese. A lot of people wonder just kind of how Nebraska was going to respond today, and we've seen them playing with tons of emotion early in this game.
See the hug there with Barney Cotton and his son Sam, sophomore, who will remain a Cornhusker. Pass from Kessler out in the flat to Justin Davis. The ball might have been deflected as third down coming. And, you know, Barney Cotton yesterday, he's an emotional guy, and talked about how during the luncheon he got a little choked up a couple of times talking to the team, and even when he was recounting some stories to us about telling his sons that Bo Pelini had been fired, he would be moving on. And it was a difficult thing for him, a Nebraska guy who played for Tom Osborne, as Kessler has now missed his last five. That last one ruled incomplete. Davis didn't quite get his hands underneath until USC will have to punt again. And this coaching staff, which had won 9 games or more in each of the 7 seasons with Bo Pelini at the helm, but they had also lost at least 4 games in every season, with the exception of this year, only 3 losses coming into this game. And ultimately, the reason, according to Sean Eichhorst, the athletic director, for the change was not necessarily the number of wins and losses, but
ball start, offense number 2. Half the distance to the goal, 4th down.
And Dory Jackson giveth any taketh away, but he's given more than he's taken away with a touchdown. It's his 2nd penalty tonight. Actually, 3rd when you count the unsportsmanlike conduct for the flip into the end zone. Keeps returning kickoffs 98 yards. They'll let him do it. Let's get that punt out of there. Pierce Nell is a dangerous punt returner. He's not going to have a chance to return this one, but Nebraska once again will have terrific field position. 36-yard punt. As Nebraska has had terrific positioning in each of its drives so far tonight. Now, Bo Pelini, after he was fired, had a meeting with the Cornhuskers. It was an emotional one at a high school in Lincoln. Word of what was said, a recording of it, got out to the press, and this is what was reported. Pelini saying, referring to Eichhorst, he doesn't even understand what a core value is. He's a expletive lawyer who makes policy. After news of that broke, Nebraska issued a statement saying it only reaffirmed their decision why he is no longer a leading young man at the University of Nebraska. Amir Abdullah is down to the 30, and the point of all of that is that not only does Mike Riley have to coach the team, he's got to deal with a lot of bruised feelings, a lot of hurt young men, and sort of get everybody pulling back in the same direction.
And it seemed like, too, with Nebraska fans and the way Nebraska ran the program, it wasn't Bo Pelini's winning 9 games, because very few programs do that every single year. It seemed like it was the antics that came along with it. and some of the behavior that people were always talking about that he was doing. And that quote right there is probably what Nebraska people were talking about the most.
Well, it was an extremely volatile relationship. I think everybody understands that. I mean, you remember last year that audio tape surfaced that was vocally criticizing fans after winning against Ohio State in 2011. And hopefully he said he didn't have the support of his athletic director, Chancellor Perlman, and you just kind of got the feeling as it was going on. Aside from anything that happened on the field, it was just time for both parties to part ways.
Nebraska just picked up a first down on the completion of Brandon Riley. Tommy Armstrong keeping it, runs into his own man, but still is going to get a little help from his offensive lineman. That's Jake Cotton. That's Barney Cotton's son, who's playing his final game. And Jake's a wise veteran coach's son, so he just pulls his quarterback forward a little bit. Allowable these days.
Yeah.
In the old days, not so much. Pickup of 7 for Armstrong. Armstrong firing it into traffic. It'll be 3rd down and 3. Leonard Williams was applying the heat. Now there is a flag.
That could be a significant one, too.
If Leonard Williams gets called for targeting here.
Personal foul in the passer, number 94. Half the distance to the goal, 1st down.
Very fortunate that wasn't followed with targeting.
And you see him come flying in there.
No, it wasn't.
No, that was just that was the excessive throwdown, which you can't do. You know that as a defensive lineman. You can hit the quarterback right there, but you got to let him go. You can't throw him to the ground.
Again, we talked about this Nebraska offensive line playing with a 3rd-string center, 2 backup right tackles, and they're having issues right now with big number 94 on the right side. Yeah.
You're the starters, backups, it doesn't matter.
Get in line, pal.
That's why the NFL's in line.
That's going to be a short line. You might have to be real close to the front of that line. Get a shot to have 94 on your squad. 1st down and goal after the penalty. Armstrong. This time Leonard throws him down well within the confines of the rules.
Yep.
He's such a versatile player.
And here's a late flag coming in.
Wow. Just going to say that the versatility and the ability to stop the run as a 6'5", 300-pounder in a 3-4 scheme at defensive end, but also the ability to rush the passer and the natural quicks he has, but
unsportsmanlike conduct, defense number 94. Half the distance to the goal, automatic 1st down.
Needs to calm down a little bit. Just wonder if this was it because of excess celebration? Causing attention to himself. I see players do that each and every week. Let's take a look at this again.
And there's the move, which is a great quick move, uses hands. You know what? I like celebration in football. I like excitement. Now he's going over to the bench right there, and you can't go and taunt the bench.
Yeah. That's what it is. It's taunting.
But again, as long as they're consistent throughout the game, they're okay with it.
Armstrong keeping it, looking for running room. It's not unusual to see USC draw a lot of penalties.
Yeah, I mean, but that's 9 already.
Yeah, well, they're right on their average.
Yeah,
5th most in the country. And
well, we're not at halftime yet.
We're not the 2nd quarter.
Yeah, I mean, so they're well on their way here, but the field position, too, has been killing them. I mean, giving up great field position, penalties. It's not been a crisp start for USC by any stretch.
You want them to play loose, want them to have fun, but you got to have a little more discipline than perhaps they've shown. Armstrong, wide open receiver, and the freshman goes in for the touchdown. It's Mornay Pearson L, and Nebraska regains the lead. Mornay Pearson L celebrated a birthday yesterday. Happy birthday to me, he says after making the grab.
Well, you're going to see Kenny Bell number 80 and Westerkamp number 1. They run this crossing pattern. That clears the entire field out. There was no one left underneath to tackle number 15, Pearson L for Nebraska.
The Cornhuskers have had a most productive 1st quarter, and Big Red has a 17-10 lead.
And Armstrong's had some good throws. He's missed some throws, too, but great job reading the defense. You want to go to Bell, probably his main man, number 80. They took him away. Reads it, makes the perfect throw. Nebraska's offense is doing a great job with 17 points already.
The passing game as well. They've had a lot of their explosive plays. Yeah, throwing the football. They've come out, they've been aggressive. We've seen trick plays. The big picture, I've been really impressed with Barney Cotton as the interim head coach, but the effort this football team is playing with. Remember, we weren't sure. We knew they felt resentment coming in after the firing of Bo Pelini and whether they were going to be demoralized or not. That has not been the case. Barney Cotton told his guys over and over and over, honor God, your teammates, and Bo Pelini with your effort in this game. And they've done exactly that here early.
He told them it was one more opportunity to reveal their character. Boy, so far, so good. They're going to try to keep the ball. The idea was to keep it away from Adoree Jackson. That didn't work. This time, a lot of white jerseys there to get him. He's knocked down. USC will have it as we check in with Adnan Burke.
All right, Reese, thank you very much. The Sports Center right now presented by Great Clips. The college basketball game of the day, Kentucky over Louisville, 58-50. Kentucky's first game this season decided by less than 10 points. John Calipari improving to 12-9 versus Rick Pitino. Reese, back to you.
All right, Adnan. You know, coming into this game, one of the themes was, and it still could unfold this way, final game for Amir Abdullah, almost certainly the final game for Leonard Williams, and we've heard from Leonard Williams, both on the good and bad side, but this game thus far has really been controlled by the future stars, Demorne Pearsonell making plays for Nebraska, Adoree Jackson doing so for USC, a lot of young talent on both sides in this game.
I always felt like the bowl week was when a lot of true freshmen, the light kind of goes on. You're talking about guys that have been starting all year long, but for a lot of young players on both these teams, big time to develop.
Cody Kessler had missed his previous five passes, which is newsworthy in and of itself for a guy who's completing nearly 71% on the season. That was an easy one to Randall Telfer, but not many yards after the catch.
Now setting up third and long. We talked about this pass rush. It's not just Andy Gregory, number four, but Malik Collins, number seven, a defensive tackle inside, can win his one-on-one battles. How does this young offensive line hold up? Number four now, playing linebacker right over the middle of the ball.
Nebraska coaches thought that movement gave the young USC offensive line trouble. See a little shifting, moving guys around. Gregory standing up. Good protection. Good pass. Aguilar has it for the first down, and he's finally knocked down at the 45 as Kessler finds his favorite target.
And part of it is going to be picking up Gregory on the outside, and you see number 50 doing a great job. But you're talking about a true freshman going against one of the best players, best pass rushers in college football, giving Cody Kessler time to find his target.
Toa Lobendon is going to be a name that
yes,
people
he is.
Know.
That's an athletic
well.
Tackle.
He can play anywhere on the offensive line, and he's doing a good job at left tackle for USC in his freshman season. First quarter has come to a close. Nebraska and USC in a good one. Cornhuskers up by 7.
Nebraska leads the Trojans by a touchdown as we start the second quarter from San Diego. But tonight, I can tell you, on this Nebraska sideline, it's been very, very energized, but it's run the gamut of emotions. We've even seen assistant coaches get so angry they had to be separated on the sideline, and a lot of excitement also. But I can tell you this, Barney Cotton's been playing peacemaker down here. He knows these USC guys are trying to get into his player's head. He told Amir Abdullah, just walk away. We came here to win the game. Don't respond, guys.
All right, Sam, you often wonder whether teams are really energized when it comes to a bowl game, and often that determines who wins and loses. It appears thus far that both teams are pretty energized for their respective reasons.
Well, we know that Nebraska is a tough team to throw against, so the USC needs to get back to this, running the ball.
Old school running game is what has given Nebraska problems at times.
Yeah, to the tune of 862 yards in the last two games. I mean, it's not real good. So you'd think they'd commit to the run game a little bit better. But I tell you what, Nebraska's field position has been so good so far. Look at that. Own 49.
This is the own 15. Buck Allen gets drilled in the backfield on third down, and he didn't get it. It'll be fourth down and about a yard. Josh Banderas, who's starting for the injured Trevor Roach, although Josh has played a lot, the linebacker for Nebraska this year. David Santos also out at linebacker, and USC leaving the offense on the field on fourth down. Shotgun snap. They give it to Buck Allen, and Allen will have the first down.
Four straight runs. Get that attitude going that just talking about. Jesse talked about the freshman on the offensive line. You want to help him out a little bit, too, in the pass throw situations. Run the ball. Then you can play action. Then you can slow those guys down a little bit.
Another running play. Allen bouncing it to the outside. And Buck, who had a terrific season, ran for more than 1,300 yards, but he's had 93 or fewer yards in his last three games.
This is the best pulling center in college football, Max Turk. Watch the athleticism of number 75 and his ability to run outside, get a hat on a linebacker in the second level.
Threw it that time off the play fake, and Kessler found the senior Randall Telfer, and Telfer gets it into the red zone, and USC is threatening after the pickup of 20.
You talk about this young offensive line. Max Turk, you could argue, is the MVP of this offense. Lining up behind beside all these young guys, he's got to make all the calls, get everybody on the same page. He had to replace Marcus Martin, who was a first-team All-Pac-12 center last year. After Turk played left tackle and left guard, he's been unbelievable this season as a center.
So we have a timeout on the field, 13-11 remaining in the second quarter. Pleased to be joined here in the booth by the new head coach at Nebraska, Mike Riley. Mike, welcome as you're watching what's been an entertaining first quarter by your future team. Long tenure at Oregon State. Mm-hmm. What was it that made this opportunity the right one for you?
Well, it was actually very difficult. I think the best way for me to describe it is kind of right place, right time, and still very, very hard. You know, I guess I feel good about it, Reese, because I'm leaving a place I love, I enjoyed, and I'm going to something that's a little new, exciting, different. So in both respects, I feel good about it.
You've had people reach out before, USC, UCLA, Alabama over the years. Your name was connected with those. Why was your reaction different this time as opposed to the other one, the first time they reached out to you?
You know, I think it was. It's probably at the stage of my career, my age. You know, I think that, you know, I've done a lot of fun things in coaching, and I'm, you know, 61. I've been there a long time. This may be my last shot to try something different, something new. So we took it.
Continue our visit with Mike Riley in a moment. Cody Kessler, plenty of time, throws to Nelson Aguilar, and it's a touchdown for the Trojans.
I've seen that one before.
Yeah, yes, you have. And a lot of people have. Among Power 5 pass-catch combinations, they have the highest completion percentage of anybody. Mike, tell me what happened here.
Well, again, you know, they get the man-to-man coverage in the back, and probably on a play like that, if you don't have under coverage help of some kind, it's going to be very tough for the defensive back to make the play.
Good night in that case as Aguilar hauls in the touchdown. We're an extra point away from being tied. And we are at 17. So now Nebraska will get the ball back. Mike, we've spent a lot of the first quarter talking about the emotion of the Nebraska players after the dismissal of Bo Pelini. Mm-hmm. When you go into a new situation, what is your plan to handle that emotion and try to bring everybody under your regime?
You know, what happened, what the biggest factor is, you know, in all of this is, you know, there's a big change in all the people that have coached, have recruited these kids. So the uncertainty is for the players in the program. And you can't really change that overnight. It is a process. So you go in and you start building that relationship that ends up being a team, and it's fun to do. But like I've already talked to the team one time, and I told them this isn't going to happen overnight. This is something that happens and is built over a nice period of time. So we're going to just start coaching and get going to work.
How would you respond or describe the players' response to that first meeting we watched Amir Abdullah return to kickoff?
You know, I think it has to be very strange for them. Boy, this Amir, I wish Amir was coming back.
Yeah, you'd like to have, that's his second great kickoff of the night. He had 4,500 yards rushing in his career. I don't think the NCAA would give you another year with Amir Abdullah.
Oh, man. You know, no, I've had enjoyed talking to him, actually, and out of Homewood High in Alabama.
Close to your home?
Yes, exactly right. My family's home. Yes, exactly right. So, but in reaction to the meeting, I was really interested in what that reaction would be because, you know, here comes this guy they don't know, and I didn't recruit him. I haven't coached him. But I really liked the fact that one by one, at the end of the meeting, they came by and we shook hands. And then about 15, 20 of them stood around. We talked some football. So it actually ended up being pretty comfortable. Oh, we're going deep.
Armstrong taking the shot, looking for Kenny Bell, who made a great grab in the end zone earlier. It's incomplete. It'll be second down and 10. Josh Shaw is on the coverage. So, Mike, I don't know. I'm not going to put you on the spot, but one of your many talents in dealing in interpersonal relationships, you remember names like crazy. You got your work cut out for you now, pal.
Yes,
a lot of new names to learn.
100. that's not real easy, but it'll be fun. It'll be fun, and I'm going to miss Oregon State and all the people there. And like I said in the press conference recently,
I got a lot more out of Oregon State than they did out of me, but I really love my time there. So it's hard to leave. It'll be exciting to arrive, and we'll just go from there.
From the number of times you faced USC, did you talk to the interim staff at all in terms of game plan at all with
yes,
this game?
Yes, they asked some questions. We talked to them. It was actually kind of fun, give and take. You know, we have played them a lot. The one thing I told them is don't give up a Hail Mary right before the half, which we did. It really changed the game big time. So that was probably my biggest piece of advice for them.
Hey, Mike.
Ball start. Offense. Number 55, 5 yard, third down.
Mike, congratulations on the new job. I know you'll do great there and wish you the best of luck. Thanks for stopping by.
Appreciate you having me on, Bruce. Right. Thank you.
Mike Riley, new head coach at Nebraska. And by the way, I asked him a minute ago where he was sitting, and he gave me the section number immediately. He should. He used to coach the Chargers here, so he knows Qualcomm Stadium a little bit as well. After the false start penalty, a third and 15 for Tommy Armstrong Jr. and Nebraska.
Better find number 94 and block him. Leonard Williams has been in the backfield all game.
Armstrong gets rid of it and is almost intercepted by Plattenberg, who was shaken up earlier in the game. Good to see him back on the field, but he'd like to have been able to hang on to that one, I'm sure. Fourth down coming.
Those are the ones, safeties, man. You're looking back there reading the quarterback's eyes. He throws a bad ball, a perfect opportunity, hits you right in the hands.
That was a rope, too. I mean, if he caught that, he was going to earn it.
That's how you pad your stats, though, man. You got to catch those bad throws, errant throws, miscommunication.
If you were really good at catching it, he'd be on offense.
True. Right? Very good point.
Aguilar back up inside his tent. He's wrestled to the ground and slung down into the ESPN sign at about the 15. Out in beautiful San Diego Harbor, the National University Holiday Bowl is tied at 17 in the second.
The gestation period of the common muskrat is 1 month. The president.
Bowl week rolls on Tuesday. We'll start with the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl. Notre Dame on a four-game losing streak, taking on LSU. Georgia and Louisville. Georgia offensive coordinator Mike Bobo moving on to Colorado State. Former Georgia defensive coordinator Todd Grantham now leading the defense for Louisville. And then at 10 o'clock Eastern time, Maryland and Stanford in the Foster Farms Bowl right in the Cardinal backyard. We have another Pac-12, now Big Ten matchup. Cody Kessler under duress, gets it to Juju Smith, and a terrific job by Kessler in the pocket, managing the pressure and delivering a completion.
Yeah, you ain't lying. I mean, he backs up, gets into his drop, puts his back foot in the ground, and watch him feel and kind of move around with the play action. Step up, move to his right, see his receiver, throw as he's getting hit, throw a perfect pass.
Buck Allen up close to the 30, Vincent Valentine on the stop.
Hey guys, Cody Kessler, totally under the radar all season long. You could argue the most underappreciated, underrated quarterback in the country. He's having the most efficient year a USC quarterback has ever had. Think of all the great names that have played there. His stats are off the charts, and this is not a dink and dunk offense. They throw it downfield.
And again, Kessler has to get rid of it before he gets hit. And
that was a dink.
Kessler, it was. But you know what? Kessler has been under duress, they got 23% of the time. That's about 3% more than the average Power 5 quarterback, yet he still put up these types of numbers.
He statistically is the most accurate deep ball thrower of any Power 5 quarterback in the country. He's thrown 5 picks in his last 17 games.
Kessler can't get away from the duress this time. Malik Collins knocks him down, and the Huskers force a punt.
We talked about the pass rush Nebraska has inside. A lot of defenses, or sorry, offensive lines like to double team number four, Randy Gregory, but you forget about this big guy right here. Just working inside on the one-on-one. That's only his four. He only has 4.5 sacks this year, guys, but he had 13 quarterback hurries coming into the game. That affects quarterbacks, and you see Kessler on the ground.
That works out well. It kind of hid behind his other guy and just popped in there.
Warne Pearson L. Didn't get a chance to return this one, I don't think. It might have been deflected off of something. Pearson L has.
Off his foot?
Yeah.
It's a terrible
play. I was trying to help him out somehow. Pearson L's taking three back for touchdowns, so maybe it's a good idea just to kick an ugly one and make sure he can't run with it. Also a very good idea to get right in the mustache of Cody Kessler. That's what Malik Collins did in Nebraska.
San Diego County Credit Union. It's not big bank banking. It's better. Dunkin' Donuts. America runs on Dunkin'. And Ultra HD from Vizio. Nothing is more captivating.
A lot of terrific things to do in San Diego. Both teams got to visit SeaWorld. You saw some of the fellas getting a little sugar from the various sea creatures around, sea lion.
It's kind of brave, isn't it? I don't know if I get that close.
It's not Shark Week, it's SeaWorld. Although, you know, could be more pleasant things perhaps than having a sea lion sort of put its whiskers in your ear.
Yeah, having Leonard Williams hit you.
Yeah, that's much more unpleasant. But Nebraska, at least when its offense is on the field, has had splendid field position. This drive started at their own 43, average starting position at the 49. Pickup of a couple by Amir Abdullah. Scott Felix on the stop to bring up third down.
There's a mass substitution by USC coming on the field now. Claude Pallone, a defensive tackle, number 90. He's a pass rush specialist on third down. Trying to get pressure now on Tommy Armstrong. We got Leonard Williams. We've been circling him all game inside a defensive tackle. See him right here. Got to give number four time.
Williams picked up by a couple of guys. Armstrong fires it. It was almost intercepted again. Second opportunity for John Plattenberg to get an interception, and it would be the first of his career, and he hasn't been able to hang on to a couple.
You know, guys, you were talking earlier about he's trying to, you know, it's hard to make these plays. You see, it's like a post throw. The receiver never breaks inside. Plattenberg drops it again.
Look at Josh Hall.
You were saying that's why he doesn't play on offense, guys. It's hard to see the field joking on offense, yeah, as a true freshman. Yeah. You got Juju Smith and Adoree Jackson taking your reps. The Plattenberg, who played the best game of the year that he had against Notre Dame, the last regular season game, he's had some early opportunities.
He has been good in the secondary. I was only kidding about the flop earlier. That was a tougher catch. The first one. I didn't like to have both of them. The first one is probably one I think John would tell you he should have grabbed. The punt goes in to the end zone, and USC will have it on the 20. Here's the latest dish brought to you by Dish Network. New Year's Day, the college football playoff has recaptured New Year's Eve and New Year's Day. Here are the national semifinals. The Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. 5 o'clock Eastern, 2 on the West Coast. That will pit Oregon and Florida State, the 2 and 3 seeds. And then the nightcap from New Orleans, number 1 Alabama, number 4 Ohio State in the All-State Sugar Bowl. Culminates with the college football playoff championship presented by AT&T on January 12th. Here is Adoree Jackson getting his opportunity on offense. We've seen him on defense. We've seen him on special teams. And now Jackson getting a carry on offense.
They use him as a decoy a lot, too, on offense. When he takes the field, the defense is very, very aware. I think Steve Sarkisian, this coaching staff, has just done an outstanding job of kind of limiting his reps but putting him in the game at opportune times. And he's had his moments. He's made an impact in games, not just on defense and on special teams, but on offense as well. Special player.
Aguilar makes a move. Nelson Aguilar up to the 40-yard line.
And that's what makes him special. Sticking the foot in the ground like most people can't do in college football. He is so quick, so dynamic. Good job by Kessler seeing man-to-man coverage, getting Aguilar the ball, letting him do the rest.
5 catches, putting him over 100 for the season. Darius Rogers wrapped up immediately Daniel Davey was there to throw him down.
You know, USC is an offense. They want to throw the football deep down the field, but we talked about how good this pass defense is from Nebraska and how small the windows are. And early in this game, USC's had to throw the football short and try and let guys like Aguilar and some of these other receivers make defenders miss. But Nebraska's been very good so far, I think, this game, for the most part, tackling in the open field.
Kessler, with Gregory right at his feet, had to shuffle him and threw low over the middle. It'll be third down.
Yeah, that time Lobendon, left tackle, that true freshman, number 50, he was one-on-one outside with number four. You'll see the matchup here. I mean, this is tough for a true freshman, as athletic as he is, facing off against a top 10 pick, and that's just a smart decision by number six to get rid of him.
Aguilar first one way, then the other. Now roll Kessler away from the pressure, and he's right on target to Aguilar. You see him lunge to try to get the first down, and he did. What a play by Nelson Aguilar.
And you saw Gregory win the last battle this time. They keep the tight end in them on the top and the tackle, so you got two guys to block, roll away from him. And look at that throw again by Kessler. Perfect throw. Great job by Aguilar toe-tipping the sideline.
I like the way they move Aguilar around the field. He's never lined up in the same spot, outside, inside. So a defense can never really get a beat on him. You can create matchup advantages like you saw right there.
And Nelson getting a break right now. Kessler has to get rid of it. He's trying to force it to George Farmer, who is well covered by Josh Mitchell.
This Nebraska defense, they don't love to blitz on first and second down. They tend to be more vanilla on the base defensive downs. That was a nice change-up call right there by their defensive coordinator, John Papuchis, giving Cody Kessler a different look.
Kessler has hit 15 out of 24. It's harder to complete a pass against this defense statistically than any other. Freshman tight end lined up split wide. Bryce Dixon.
He's
down inside the 45.
He's going to have a big time future. This guy is very athletic. He's got tremendous speed. Creates mismatch advantages for them as well. He was the number one tight end coming out of high school last year. He's got a big time future. This is a guy, defensive coordinators in the Pac-12. They're not going to want to see a lot of here in the coming years.
Just put them on the list, dude. 14 or 13, 2, 9. I mean, USC skilled playmakers, they're there, that's for sure.
Justin Davis, first throw. Justin Davis inside the 20 before he's finally wrestled down by Corey Cooper, and USC's threatening.
The times this year Nebraska has struggled against the run, Minnesota and Wisconsin, they've had bad tackling. Watch Nate Jerry, the safety number 25 at the top of the screen. He's got an opportunity in the hole to make the play. He doesn't get it done.
Davis.
Same play.
Crashing down inside the 10.
And then you've got Justin Davis. He's your backup running back. This guy starts for a lot of programs around the country as we're talking about talent and skill spots. It runs deep here at USC, and a lot of these guys are coming back next year.
Buck Allen picks up the first down. Well, those previous two runs by Davis, I know it's a little bit different in scheme, but very reminiscent of the old student body right that the Trojans used to run under John McKay so effectively. A first and goal. Allen picking his way, getting a little help from his wide receiver, Darius Rogers. It'll be second down and goal.
And they're going quick tempo. It's a good job. Don't let the defense substitute. You got them where you want them. You're running the football. Continue to do it so they can't sub. Nebraska just tried to run somebody on the field, but USC's not subbing, so they can't.
Allen, touchdown, USC.
We talked about Max Turk and how good and how athletic he is as a center. This guy used to play left tackle. Watch 75 come around the outside and get a seal block here to free the running back. Just tremendous hips. He opens him up. He pins around tight, gets the block on the middle linebacker. That's just too easy. It's such an advantage and a luxury when you have a center and you've got offensive linemen as athletic as USC has.
Adari's on to make it a 7-point lead for USC. So you guys wanted to see the Trojans go to the ground a little bit more, and they certainly did so on that drive. Got good runs from Justin Davis. Then they got the payoff from the first team all Pac-12 running back, Buck Allen. some of the shorefront in San Diego area, one of the most beautiful spots on earth, sun setting at this point and figuratively setting on a couple of eras in Nebraska football. The Bo Pelini regime is over officially, with Pelini not being on the sideline, Barney Cotton on an interim basis, and then the final game for Amir Abdullah, one of the great players in Nebraska history, second Cornhuskers all-time rush list.
You guys seem to be smart not to kick it to him again. Hasn't worked out real well for him so far.
See some of the Cornhusker fans, and boy, did they travel. They're so loyal. USC going to make sure that Mornay Pearsonell doesn't get his hands on it. Instead, they're going to give up great field position across the 40-yard line again. Adnan Virk is in the studio. Adnan.
Reese, there hasn't been this much excitement at Yankee Stadium since Derek Jeter's final hit. Penn State with an absolute thriller. We'll show you what happened between them and Boston College. Plus, a wild one, a devil of a game, one might say, between the Sun Devils and the Blue Devils. And the major participants arriving for the college football playoff, Robert Smith, Butch Davis, and I at the half. And make sure you wish Jesse a happy belated Boxing Day. Reese, back to you.
Thank you, Adnan. That's a huge day for all of us. Big sales. By the way, have you guys noticed Adnan's new haircut? He's got the comb over going.
Yeah.
He looks wealthy.
Boxing Day is big in Canada, and apparently so too is determining someone's wealth by their hairstyles.
Can't hide money, Reese. Adnan's got lots. A lot of loonies and toonies. He knows what I'm talking about.
How's the exchange rate?
You know, it was favorable a few more years ago.
Amir Abdullah knocked down right at the line of scrimmage. It'll bring up third down and long. So despite the fact that Nebraska once again got advantageous field position, right now USC seems to be starting to assert itself.
Yeah, Reese, and what they've done is they've won first down. They've set up third and long situations for Tommy Armstrong. These have been hard to convert.
See if Armstrong can regain some momentum for the Children of the Corn. Armstrong firing and broken up. Kevon Seymour was there. Timed it perfectly, and Nebraska has his third straight three and out.
The secondary for USC as the season's gone on, I think, has gotten better and better. And a lot of that has been Adoree Jackson growing up as a true freshman. A lot of it's been getting Josh Shaw back for these last couple games. But Kevon Seymour, 6 feet tall, 185 pounds, too. I mean, it is hard. We talk about how hard it is to throw against Nebraska. Not so easy against USC either.
Sam Foltz. Gets rid of it. Nelson Aguilar watches it go out of bounds. Let's see where they mark it. It hit ground right at the 15 and went out at the 18. So that's where USC will take over. And here is Nelson Aguilar, all-conference performer. Might be his final game as a
coach. Well, he's the go-to guy. We know that week in, week out. And already Cody Kessler has targeted him 8 times. We talked about it earlier. They do a great job lining him up all over the field, inside, outside, short throws, deep throws down the middle. He catches the football in traffic, having himself a very good game. And as you mentioned, it was what might be his last game as a Trojan.
See where he is now. He's seventh in the country, 103 receptions, up to the second. It's the third most in the season by a Trojan, and he's got over 1,300 yards. That's 10th in the country, and he's been Kessler's security blanket. Cody's going to take off himself. Cody used the B button. I'm not really sure he needed the spin there.
No, he didn't need the circle button. But he did a good job stepping up in the pocket.
Some of us like the Xbox.
Circle button. It's a slow circle button, Reese. Watch. It's kind of a...
This is a super slow-mo.
Well, now, wait. It's actually in slow motion.
We know. It was real life.
Not that you could tell the difference. I'm going to be getting a phone call from Cody's family after that.
And Plattenberg's family.
I backtracked on that one. How many times did I mention how well Plattenberg played against Notre Dame? And he's played well tonight. So too is Kessler under duress. Gets rid of it. Dixon's got running room. He's got a first down. And Dixon had really good practices during the bowl preparation period. We anticipated seeing him more involved in the offense, and so far tonight we have.
These guys are scary to death with their speed. They say speed kills. USC has it everywhere. And if it's Aguilar, if it's Juju Smith, George Farmer, Dory Jackson, now you've got Dixon at tight end. You've got two running backs in Buck Allen and Justin Davis that can take it to the house. These guys are a play away from scoring. It's an embarrassment of riches at the skill positions.
Kessler taking a shot for Aguilar. Nelson, and it's picked off. Big play by Josh Mitchell, a native of the state of California. And he picks off Cody Kessler. Just the fifth interception Cody's thrown this year.
I think if you're going to miss a deep throw, especially on a go route, yeah, you can't miss it short and you can't miss it inside. That's a tremendous job by cornerback Josh Mitchell, locating the football, getting his hands off of the wide receiver, and plucking it with two hands.
Aguilar, I thought, could have helped his receiver, his quarterback out a little bit more, too. Right here, track the football, come back to it, at least play defense and knock the football down. Did a poor job of waiting for the football to come.
Mitchell is one of six Cornhuskers from the state of California. He had a tumultuous relationship with Bo Pelini at times, almost kicked off the team on a couple of occasions. But after Pelini was dismissed, he tweeted his appreciation for the influence that Pelini had had on him and giving him another opportunity to get his act together. He's had a really good senior season for Nebraska.
That's something coaches and players always go through. It's like your dad. They got to discipline you. They got to be tough on you. But you know it's in your best interest in the end.
The worst starting field position of the night. And that's going to help, but that's going to be a face mask. Surely. And did he get the front of the shoulder pads? This sure looked like Claude Pallone got a handful of face masks just the way Abdullah went down. Let's see. So he got the pads or the face.
He got his jersey. Yeah. He actually touched the face mask, but he never grabbed and twisted it. That's why it should be no foul.
Armstrong on the roll, and Armstrong fires it into tight coverage. And what a first half DeMornay Personnel is having. And a Trojan draped all over him and made the grab.
And you can't let Armstrong outside the pocket. That's the second time Tobias done that. You got to keep him inside the pocket. Stay outside and make him stay inside so he has to beat you from the room.
Kenny Bell spins away for a man. Bell getting up close to midfield before Plattenberg chases him out of bounds, and the interception's given Nebraska a little juice.
And it's the first time in a long time Nebraska's had their two best players, Amir Abdullah and Kenny Bell, close to 100%. These guys have had their various injuries throughout the course of the year, but tonight we're seeing these guys look way better, and both these guys making plays.
Terrell Newby's at running back right now. Amir's only averaged 2.5 yards per carry so far. He hasn't been able to get loose. Armstrong firing it deep and overshooting Jordan Westerkamp.
It's a nice idea by offensive coordinator Tim Beck, though, to be aggressive. You've thrown a couple of those short, quick screens. See if you can catch USC sleeping. But again, on the back end, this secondary, they've been pretty tuned in and dialed in. And the throws that Tommy Armstrong has hit, they haven't been gimme throws. Small windows that USC's defensive backs have forced.
Armstrong's completion percentage not great in the second quarter. Jesse, you mentioned Tim Beck. He's coaching tonight in the field, typically in the press box, but the changes and the interim staff that's down there closer to his quarterback is Abdullah. Oh, Amir. Fear Amir. Boy, he turned not much of anything into something pretty good. Abdullah just a little bit short of the first down.
Ace Pillard wants to run out there from the middle linebacker spot. Look at that little shake. Nope.
Plattenberg, nope.
Oh, man. Hey, it ain't Pillard's fault either. There's a lot of folks that have tried that. Built low to the ground, quick, strong. Good luck.
And with the problem that Amir had with the MCL, it was good to see him making those moves. Direct snap to Terrell Newby. He has the first down.
How much volume of running plays does Nebraska have, guys? When you watch the film, they run zone, power counter, they pull lineman, misdirection, wildcat. They've got every quarterback running the book. They go option, jet sweep. You talk about Barney Cotton, their run game coordinator, and Tim Beck, their offensive coordinator. They load the play call sheet with so many different running schemes. And it's a good thing USC should feel fortunate having the extra time to prepare for this game. That's a lot of offense to have to handle.
Trojans going to take a little extra time to catch their breath. USC calls a timeout. Nebraska with 2.5 to go in the first half on the move. A look at the SeaWorld Tower. Aerial coverage brought to you by DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get
DirecTV. Great shots in San Diego and the harbor area. Freeways moving along. We've got a great crowd at Qualcomm Stadium tonight. These two story programs squaring off. And boy, they put on a show in the first half. Nebraska trying to get even, trailing by seven. Tarmi Armstrong Jr. firing down the middle. He's got his man. A catch of the 15 by number 15, DeMorne Pearsonell.
First part of this play is tremendous protection, giving Tommy Armstrong a clean pocket to throw from. Just inside, there's some push up front. Look, he's got all day, 8 yards in front of him to see the field. That's a tremendous job by Pearson.
Two, he's already in the shotgun, and he takes an eight-step drop to give him plenty of room because he's not super tall. But Liv is a nice throw down the field.
Nebraska's 2 of 3, scoring touchdowns in the red zone. Trying to make it 3 of 4, all kinds of time. Now Tommy's being chased, and now he's being caught.
Gotta
he would have been better
away.
Off to throw that one away.
Got to throw that away, man, just to not be behind the sticks. Listen, the rush was there quick, and he didn't have a play to be made. But you throw it out of bounds, you don't lose 5 yards. Leonard Williams, look at him using his hands and just walking 330-pound lineman back. Throw it away, right there. Throw it to the crowd.
Yeah, and I think Tommy Armstrong's a good enough athlete. If things aren't open downfield after your second progression, he's good enough to just go take off and try and get what he can get. I think he needs to get back to doing that as this game moves on. He's a tremendous athlete at the QB spot.
Fake to Abdullah. Kenny Bell has it. Bell. Hayes Pillard has him at about the 13, maybe the 12-yard line. It'll be third down. They need to get it to the 5 for the first down.
Their go-to guy. You see Mike Riley in the crowd. He's chatting it up with the locals.
Coach.
It's about as close as you guys are ever going to get, so enjoy it. Critical third. He's got the hoodie. Look at him. He looks official. He's got the jacket now. Critical third down, guys.
Mike might have been trying to go incognito there, pulling the hoodie up. Third down and 8. Trojans bringing pressure. Armstrong. Throw back, and it is intercepted by Sua Cravens.
We just talked about Armstrong. When the play's not there, throw the football away. Another example, this is a design throwback. USC doesn't blitz a lot, but look at Armstrong. He's throwing back all the way across the field. Throws it into man coverage, and a heck of a play by Cravens.
Give Sua Cravens a lot of credit, guys. He was a freshman All-America safety last year. They moved him to linebacker this season. And it's a good spot for him because he can play the run, he can blitz the passer, and he can cover. So take a look at this again. Make sure he caught this throw. Looks like he had it in his right arm. Did the ground help him catch it?
It definitely looked like it was possibly coming out. But
the previous play is under further review.
When Sua rolled over, he had that arm underneath.
But when he
caught Justin Wilcox, the defensive coordinator.
Reese, when he caught it,
let's have a look here.
Right here, I don't know. It looks like the ball goes a little bit forward, rolls a little bit forward right there.
He's got it in his forearm.
See it there? It touches the ground there.
Yeah. I don't think he had complete and continuous control of the ball before it hit the ground.
Our rules
expert.
I wish we had
a rules expert or something that could break this
down. We've got Dave Kataya, our rules expert. And Dave, tell us the rule in terms of the ball touching the ground, how much it can move, what defines control when you go to the ground like that.
Well, the bottom line, the ball touching the ground in itself does not make the pass incomplete. What they have to look for is independent ball movement where the ground has helped him catch the ball. That's not a really good shot, and based on that, I'm not sure they can change this call. They see the ball right there, may touch the ground. The key is, can you determine a loss of control?
So you'd have to see it from that angle and then go to the other side, right, Dave?
You'd
to
have
see
to
where
put
the ball
this,
is,
you
the two
put
shots
the, try
together.
To put the two shots together if you can.
And again, importantly, the ruling on the field was that this was a catch. This was a turnover, and if there's nothing concrete, the 100% certainty you can say overturns that, then you can't change this call.
So let's take this angle now right here. Right there, the ball hits the ground.
I think he's got it all the way, David. I think that's a pick. I mean,
it's a tremendous effort.
So stands or confirmed, Reese Davis?
He stands.
After further review, the previous play stands as called. First down.
And you got to give USC a lot of credit, guys, because on the previous drive, Nebraska gets an interception. Now they're driving down the field, trying to generate points before the end of the half, knowing USC is going to get the football back first. Tremendous job. USC's had a couple opportunities in this game to come away with picks. They haven't come up with them, but Sue Cravens to the rescue deep down in his own end.
Hey, Paul, just let me tell you something. If I were replay official Richard Jordan,
yep,
I would have said confirmed. It is confirmed that Buck Allen is going nowhere.
You know what else would have been confirmed earlier? It would have been confirmed touchdown by Alex Lewis, the left tackle. Fat guy touchdown should have stood earlier in the game.
Oh, that's right. That's what we're getting to about it. If you're just joining us or joining us a little bit late, Nebraska had a play, a trick play, in which they threw back to tackle Alex Lewis, designed to be a backward pass, ruled to be a forward one. Dusty illegal, and touchdown was taken off the board. Here is that play. Pollock maintaining the ball was let go at the 15.
It was clear. You know, it was a fat guy touchdown. You can't take fat guy touchdowns off the board.
The more and more you watch that, you wonder if Sue Cravens tipped that football too.
Somebody needs to tip Buck Allen in a hurry, wearing a white jersey, and they do just in time in the final half minute of the first half. Buck found some running room, picks up 18.
This is something you're going to see USC do more here in the second half. That's a great job by the tight end Dixon, a true freshman. We've seen him make some plays catchable. How about coming back across the formation, getting a block?
So keep it on the ground. Got a couple of timeouts left, but
usually when you get a run like that, you jump start it up and you say, hey, let's give it a go. But
tough pass defense, yeah.
17.
And a good pass rush, too. Playing with a young offensive line, I don't blame Steve Sarkisian.
And the Trojans will get the ball first to start the second half as well. And they go to the locker room with a 24-17 lead. It's been a first half of fireworks. Samantha Ponders with Steve Sarkisian.
Coach, obviously a huge interception in the red zone there, but we've seen Nebraska come out very aggressively, especially on first down throwing the ball. How do you think your defense is handling it?
Well, we settled into the tempo a little bit, and we toned down our penalties. You know, we had a lot of penalties there. I think 8 in the first quarter, none in the second quarter, so we settled down a little bit.
Everybody this week has been talking about how underrated Cody Kessler is. From what you've seen tonight, what's your assessment of how he's done?
Well, we know Nebraska is an excellent pass defense, so we have to work our way through it. I think Cody's done a nice job. You know, the interception, the kid made a heck of a play. So, you know, we'll take our shots here in the second half, Sam.
Appreciate the time. Thanks, Coach.
All right, Samantha, and officially 9 penalties for 72 yards in the first half in its entirety for USC. Buck Allen went in for a score. Amir Abdullah had some moments in the first half for the Cornhuskers, and Cody Kessler put him in the spin cycle. Trojans up by 7 at the break. Wasn't just halftime in which we had fireworks. Back at the National University Holiday Bowl, USC and Nebraska provided some in the first half. 24-17, Cody Kessler and the Trojans have the lead, and they'll have the football first as we start the third quarter. Tommy Armstrong and the Huskers playing, try to finish off the season with their 10th win. Here was the first touchdown of Dory Jackson, the USC freshman.
Yeah, a true freshman getting it started. We've seen him on all three facets of the game, but he got it started on a long kick return score.
And what about the senior receiver, Kenny Bell, Nebraska's all-time receptions and receiving yards leader, making a terrific grab. And then the future of the receiving core for the Huskers, DeMorne Pearsonell with a nifty move to get in. And then in the second quarter, Kessler to Nelson Aguilar.
Yeah, the offense started getting rolling. Aguilar started getting a bunch of targets, a bunch of catches, which opened up Buck Allen in the running game. USC had it going with the rush and the pass in the second quarter.
24-17 lead for the Trojans. Both teams ran 45 plays. Both of them had 27 passes and 18 runs. The only thing that's not even necessarily is the score. USC with the touchdown lead, and they'll have it first, and Juju Smith is returning it for the Trojans. Smith spins away from tacklers, but not enough of them, and a short tackle puts it down at the 25-yard line as we go down to the field at Samantha Ponder.
Reese, Barney Cotton told me his offense still needs to attack, especially on first down. He said Tommy Armstrong started strong, but then tried to do too much and got out of the system. He said, we don't need to win because of him. We just need to win with him. I asked him to describe the mentality in the locker room. He said he's never been more proud to coach a group of guys, and he said they've been waiting 3 weeks to get this stuff off their backs. Now they just need to finish.
And Sam, we saw Amir Abdullah behind you riding a bike, warming up, and he'll hope to be able to finish strong. He was held to 32 yards in the first half. A little toss. Allen has a first down before he's knocked out of bounds by Corey Cooper. I alluded to some of the first half stats between these two in terms of play distribution. It was even. Trojans had 9 4 yards passing and did a little bit better job on the ground. Penalties hurt USC, the vast majority of those coming in the first quarter. Field position was decidedly in Nebraska's favor as Allen tries the middle.
I think a big key for Nebraska in the second half is their defensive line, and they've got to dominate. They were having success getting pressure on Cody Kessler in the first half, but Dave mentioned they started getting gashed in the running game. They're giving up 6 yards a carry right now. That can happen throughout the rest of this game. They got to start winning at the line at the point of attack.
Kessler reloads, fires long. Good coverage on Bryce Dixon by Josh Mitchell, who had an interception in the first half.
And when you run it well, you're going to get man-to-man coverage because people want to load the box, but Nebraska's secondary is held up pretty nicely in the back end. Mitchell already had the pick earlier in the game. Doing a good job with the speedy unit, the speedy wide receivers on the outside.
Well, we mentioned in the first half, David, in terms of opponent completion percentage, it was 47.5% coming into the game, opponents against Nebraska. That's best in the country. Kessler was better than that in the first half, and a missed time on the snap and a fortuitous bounce for USC. Wow. As Nelson Aguilar had the snap, hit him, and he's a little aggravated. He and Kessler exchanging some frustrated glances and words.
Take a look at this again. You're going to see 50 just running right across the formation. That's either supposed to be snapped right before he crosses or right after he crosses. And I think what they were planning to do was roll out and hit Aguilar in the flat for the first down. Obviously a little bit upset number 15 is, and Nebraska's going to get the football.
Yes, I would say right before or right after would be much better than when he's precisely
otherwise
the
otherwise it's going to hit him. Perfect timing by Max Turk.
Fourth down and 5, and USC is fortunate to get an opportunity to punt it away after that mishap. Good punt from Alvarado. Pearson L's getting everybody away from him. The Trojans have a chance to down it and put Nebraska in some rough field position for a rare time tonight. We showed you the advantage they had in the first half, but their first possession tonight is going to start deep in their own territory. Capital One Bowl Mania continues New Year's Day on ESPN. It's not just the national semifinals, but also the Goodyear Cotton Bowl Classic. Michigan State and Baylor. Baylor replacing an offensive coordinator. Michigan State defensive coordinator Pat Narduzzi is going to be the new head coach of Pittsburgh. So some changes for both of those teams and a little bit of a clash in style.
Big clash in style. And just, it's going to be interesting. Michigan State, their best win is probably Nebraska. They got something to prove. And then Baylor proving they belong in the college football playoff to, you know, conversation and debate.
That'll be New Year's Day on ESPN. Amir Abdullah's first carry in the second half. He gets maybe a yard.
This front seven has really done a good job controlling Amir Abdullah so far in this game. And we know they're without their starting nose guard, Antoine Woods, but still, the rest of these D linemen, led by Leonard Williams, these linebackers have played downhill. And Abdullah right now, he only has 2.5 yards a carry. And this is the most healthy we've seen him since his injury against Purdue.
Abdullah in the last three games, the last four games, I should say, only had 3 runs of 15 yards or longer. And prior to that sprained MCL, he had really made his living by breaking off big runs. It was a huge part, explosive plays in the running game of the Nebraska offense. And Amir just wasn't himself after injuring the knee, and they hoped that perhaps some time off would have helped him. You see how the numbers dropped off.
I think he's healthy. I think the time off has helped him, but I think this defensive line is just dirty. I mean, they're killing the offensive line for Nebraska. There's just nowhere to go.
And you also have injuries on the Nebraska offensive line, so you also have backups there. So they're a number of factors conspiring against one of the finest running backs we've seen in college football the last 4 years. So they'll try to pass it, and another opportunity for an interception. Trojans can't quite come up with it. Valiant effort by Plattenberg.
He cannot catch the football. That's his third opportunity he's had to make an interception.
It's just been, there's also, David, been so many times, I think, tonight, Nebraska, when they've been throwing the football, Tommy Armstrong just hasn't been on the same page with wide receivers. That last time, it looked to me like he was throwing a go route to the outside. Kenny Bell broke it off inside to the post inside. And again, Reese Davis' word, fortuitous, very lucky they haven't already thrown three picks.
Fultz probably needs to keep this ball away from Aguilar, who has four punt returns for touchdowns in his career, and he does that very well. And you want to talk about making the best of a situation and doing your best to flip the field. Sam Fultz did an excellent job of doing that, punting out of his own end zone and booming one 64 yards. Trojans will have it back inside their own 30, up by 7.
Behind the net, then eventually, after he's had enough fun playing keep away from all those Ottawa players, wires it and scores. Detroit takes it 3-2 in OT. We officially lost our mind, Reese. Back to you.
Adnan, that looks a lot like the junior Nepean Raiders right there, the way they're playing defense. You have to pressure the puck and create transition hockey, and right now that's something the Ottawa Senators just do not know how to do.
Canadian takeover continues here. The Holiday Bowl and the USC takeover. Adoree Jackson. Oh, come on, is Adoree. Have another touchdown for the freshman.
This guy was the number one recruit coming out of the state of California. And you've seen it on special teams. You've seen it on his makeup speed on defense. They love to line him up in the backfield and sneak him out into the flats. He's a different player when he has the football in his hands. It's very rare you say that about a cornerback. Charles Woodson was like that. Rod Woodson was like that. Dion was like that. Adoree Jackson just might be like that too.
Come let us adore.
21 unanswered points for USC. And they push the lead to 31-17. And Nebraska needs to get a little something going on offense. College football playoff kicks off New Year's Day. Back-to-back semifinal games will start in Pasadena, a couple hours north from where we are, with Oregon and Florida State in the Rose Bowl game presented by Northwestern Mutual. The nightcap will be the All-State Sugar Bowl, 8:30 Eastern time. Number one, Alabama. Number four, Ohio State. A lot of big-time brand names in the college football playoff. So what do you anticipate seeing? Got some time off. There are advantages in each matchup. Oregon's had an injury in the secondary. Yeah. What do you expect to see?
For that, I think it's a huge key in the Rose Bowl. Oregon's front on the defense, they have to be disruptive. That's something we saw in the Pac-12 title game against Arizona when Eric Armstead, Tony Washington, and DeForest Buckner are creating havoc. What's been an average defense all year long is very difficult to score points against, especially when you consider that Ifo Ekpere-Olamu is out in the game. So in that game, I'm looking at the D-line for Oregon.
Well, and you can point to FSU's defense, too. They've been extremely average throughout the season, especially for the talent that they have. So which defense can get stops? But for me, the move that FSU made by moving Irving to center, and now they have Johnson at left tackle, for me, that saved their season. I don't think they'd still be undefeated. They got bigger, they got stronger, they got more athletic, and I think it's going to make that offense even harder to stop.
Jameis Winston, one would think, would feel challenged. Matchup of Heisman Trophy winners. They're the underdog. Some of the Seminoles have been upset about that and been verbal about it. What about the nightcap game, the All-State Sugar Bowl? What do you expect to see there?
Well, I think for Ohio State, it's speed. You see all the speed on the perimeter. You've seen Alabama a little bit vulnerable to goes, you know, deep passing games. So they're not going to be able to hold up in the trenches blocking Alabama. So it's going to be the quick passing game and the deep passing game. If Alabama can handle that, they'll handle Ohio State.
All eyes on Cardale Jones, man. Third-string quarterback at the start of the year, 6'5", 250. But athletic quarterbacks over the years have given Nick Saban's defenses troubles. Whether it's Tim Tebow, Johnny Manziel, Cam Newton, Nick Marshall, et cetera, et cetera. You've got to be able to extend plays. You've got to be able to throw the football deep and take advantage of Devin Smith.
Brandon Riley had one catch. DeMorne Pearson-Hill who has been sensational in his own right here, just as we've seen Adoree Jackson from USC. Here, Snell has put on a show in the first two-plus quarters here in San Diego tonight, in Nebraska trying to answer that quick strike from the Trojans.
Well, do they need to answer? Because I think since the first quarter, the momentum has gone back in favor of USC.
Armstrong. Tommy Armstrong inside the 35 and down close to the 30. It'll be a first down for the Huskers.
And more pre-snap movement by Nebraska, more read option. Look right here, great job. See 90, I think he's right here on your screen. Watch them read him. They're not gonna block him. They're gonna let him go. And then the QB Armstrong is gonna make a decision whether he wants to pull that and keep it or hand the ball off. You don't have to block great players all the time. You can just let them go and read them. That's why option's hard to stop.
This time, Claude Pallone, who was the guy who was just read, gets Amir Abdullah after really, he got stuck right in the middle and got nobody on the last read.
Especially those big guys that aren't used to it. When you're 300 pounds, you're not used to being read. It's usually, you know, defensive ends or end guys on the line of scrimmage. Not used to making a decision. You better make one quick. Tackle the dive, tackle the quarterback.
Perhaps aggravated and took it down on Amir. Armstrong scrambling away. Sua Cravens trips him up, or Armstrong almost certainly would have gotten the first down.
This is what I love that Tommy Armstrong's doing. It's what he needs to keep doing. If things aren't open downfield right away, he's going to fake this handoff and look downfield. A little bit of pressure. First read's not there. You're fast enough, but take off. Get north. Get as much as you can and keep third downs manageable. I really think that's when Tommy Armstrong in this offense is at its best, when his legs are a factor.
Sua Cravens, who just made that tackle, has not yet gotten to his feet. Let's see what
he sells out, doesn't he?
Cut his legs and tripped him up. So there, he's being attended to over on the side. Sua with 5 tackles and interception tonight. We'll check on him when you come back.
Dubai National University. Keep learning at nu.edu. Foxcatcher, starring Steve Carell, Channing Tatum, and Mark Ruffalo. Now playing select cities. And Seiko.
Some of the scenic beauty here in San Diego, the people at the National University Holiday Bowl have been great hosts for us over the past few days. USC with a 31-17 lead, but Nebraska trying to draw closer as Tommy Armstrong has led his team to the 25 of the Trojans, but now faces a third down. Needs 4. Going to lead. Armstrong kept it. The Trojan faithful thought that Abdul had been knocked down in the backfield, but Armstrong kept it and got the first down.
A few plays ago, they read Claude Pallone. This time, they read number 94, Williams, who comes through and smokes Amir Abdullah.
And that's his job. That's who he's supposed to have. He's supposed to have the dive. He's supposed to have help on the outside. You see it. Pollard comes up on the outside. No, it's not Pollard.
It was Hutchings. Michael Hutchings, I believe.
Hutchings comes up on the outside. He has to come up and make that play faster.
Now motion from Newby. This time, Abdullah does have it. Amir Abdullah headed to the end zone. Touchdown, Nebraska. A 20-yard sprint for number 8.
We talked about Antoine Woods, the starting nose guard, not being in the game. His backup, Cody Temple, loses gap integrity. 98 right here. He doesn't get outside. Keep contained, and there's just too much speed from Amir Abdullah. And these receivers, they're fun to watch because they get involved in the game. It's important to them that they block, and it's not just Kenny Bell, but Jordan Westerkamp. All these guys give tremendous effort in the perimeter field, and that's one reason why they've been so successful running the football.
The wide receivers have an honor. They're called perimeter warriors. The receiver coach Rich Fisher keeps up with it. Kenny Bell, in addition to being a terrific receiver, is a vicious blocker. That time he just got in the way, and Abdullah found the crease, and Amir looked to be the picture of health.
Yeah, and that's what happens when you start seeing Armstrong have some success running the football. You have to honor that with the quarterback run game, and then it opens up for Abdullah. They've done a great job with the zone read, with the quarterback run game and Abdullah. You get both those guys going, it's a hard offense to stop.
And it's a good answer, too, by Nebraska. We talked about how the momentum was starting to shift back towards USC, and there was Nebraska. And that's kind of that style of running, the zone reads, the quarterback runs, having number eight, number four both involved. I mean, that's kind of that was the rushing offense we really saw for the most part throughout the first 8 weeks of the season, spreading the field, putting the defense in tumultuous spots to have to make tackles in space.
Squib kick, they keep it away from Jackson. Getting it to Juju Smith, not always a picnic either. Smith across the 30 as we check in with our buddy Adnan Verk.
All right, thank you very much, Reese. More data, more highlights brought to you by Sprint. And Kristen Hackenberg put up some data. Or is it data? Four passing touchdowns, tying a school single-game bowl record. His second career four passing touchdown game, but his first of this season as Penn State beats Boston College 31-30 in the Pinstripe Bowl in the Bronx. Reese, back to you.
All right, Adnan. So, Kristen Hackenberg had a difficult season at Penn State. Well, that was a thriller right before us between BC and Penn State. Buck Allen has it. Josh Banderas meets him after a short pickup.
I'm curious to see if USC is going to go to more two-back formations like they have right now. Jaleel Pinner, number 38, the fullback on the field. The last two games of the regular season, Minnesota and Wisconsin had a lot of, Iowa. Sorry, in the middle of the year, it was Wisconsin and Minnesota that had success running the football with two back sets, and USC's going to that right now.
Allen across the 40, Randy Gregory chased him down from behind, but not before Buck picks up the first down.
It's something Nebraska's defense doesn't see a lot of. Their offense doesn't run it in practice. They don't see it a lot throughout the Big Ten. And when offenses have lined up with two running backs in the backfield, they bring guys in motion. And at times, it's confused Nebraska with respect to gap integrity and knowing how to fill the lanes. So you see defensive coordinator John Papuchas here, signaling out to his gate.
Kessler wanted to throw long, check down, took the underneath to Darius Rogers, and he's got a first down.
What makes it even harder for Nebraska guys is that we know they're down two starting linebackers in this game. You see a lot of inexperience on the field for Nebraska. They're playing, for the most part tonight, in a nickel package with an extra defensive back, but as USC becomes more and more physical running the football, it's becoming tougher and tougher to stop because of the inexperience of the personnel.
I had a look at defensive back Daniel Davey as Kessler takes a shot at defensive backs, and getting in the way was Nate Gary. Juju Smith was running to try to run under it, and Gary was right man in right spot.
I think if Nate Gary had turned around, I think he had himself a pick. He got himself a tremendous position. He tries to keep his arms off of Juju Smith, but you know, Gary's got five picks on the year. He's got really good ball skills and instincts. That's a rare time. I think he just had peaked to find the football and located it, he could have caught that.
Allen, first down and more inside the 20. Buck Allen, can he get in? Touchdown, USC. Yards, Allen gets in. He's over 100 yards on the night. And the rush defense of Nebraska struggling again. Let's see if Allen was able to get in before he went down.
Oh, yeah.
He did.
You just talked about the struggles of this run defense in the middle of the season, but right there, how about that block? Mm.
Left guard, Damian.
Wow.
Cleared.
There goes
out.
That bad man.
Damian, who's your mama, just cleared out an entire side of that Nebraska defensive line.
Who's your daddy? It's Damian there. Max Turk did a good job. He had a pancake block on that thing, too, and Buck Allen took advantage of all of it. And Nebraska had an answer last time. Will they have another one?
And this is 6'5", 370 pounds of man right here at left guard. And look at that. I mean, that's just a great job.
That's on Valentine, too. That's on Vincent Valentine.
He's not a small joker.
He's a 325. Right here is the block. He just gets washed. And Damian Mama,
wow,
another one of these talented true freshmen. We're talking about all the skill guys on offense and defense, but he was a fourth-rated guard coming out of high school. He kind of shows that there. We talked about the home run hitting ability of Buck Allen earlier in this game. They've got it everywhere, man, a wide receiver and a running back. A lot of young talent. I'm telling you, if Cody Kessler decides to come back, I think this is the team to beat in the Pac-12 next year. They'll have an opportunity to reach the college football playoff.
And do you think Kessler should come back?
I think he should come back. I think physically he has things he can continue to work on, but I think he has an opportunity really to leave a legacy. I think he can do something very, very special next season. I do think Cody Kessler should come back to play his final year.
So the USC single game record was 7 touchdown passes against Colorado through 6 touchdown passes against Notre Dame. Coverage unit gets down to stop the turn just across the 30 from DeMorne Pearsonell. The Huskers will have it back, trying to answer again. Here is the Trojans' schedule next year. The non-conference schedule, not particularly daunting, save the mid-October trip to Notre Dame. Not sure what you're going to get with the Fighting Irish stumbling down the stretch.
We got 9 conference games, though, and 4 of those games against North Division opponents. Home against Washington and Stanford, on the road at Oregon, and at Cal, who's going to be better next year as well. So it's by no means a walk in the park for USC, but I think with the returning talent, if they stay healthy, and that's the key, they've got a shot to win the entire conference.
Armstrong has time. Newby has it in front. He's knocked down immediately by Josh Shaw.
Well, I say, you say if they stay healthy. I think it matters, too, not just Kessler, but Aguilar and some of the other guys that stick around for more eligibility. Guys that are, but the talent on the offensive line, obviously, coming back is going to be great. The talent at wide receiver, the defense has to continue to get better and improve, I think, in the secondary, which it will. But I agree with you. I think it's a Final Four caliber team next year. Plus, you know they're going to bring in a great recruiting class. You see all the young guys this year that are making such an impact.
Armstrong gets the lead and gets across the 35. It is significant that while USC's probation ended earlier this year, this marks the final game in which the roster will necessarily be limited, at least in terms of full-size signing classes. Now, Steve Sarkisian, we talked to him earlier. It's not going to be next year before USC is able to get closer to that 85 scholarship limit. That will probably come in 2016. But a full class of 25 this coming February will give them more depth. They have 51 recruited scholarship players dressed tonight. That's over for USC. We're doing pretty well with those 51 guys so far.
Say, Reese, it's been like that all year. I mean, they've gone week in, week out with about 50 scholarship guys ready to play. It's pretty incredible that they've won 8 games with that kind of depth, but I agree. Ideal depth. I think that's kind of the key. You said 2016. I agree with that. When your backups are scholarship players and they're not freshmen, and it hasn't been like that at USC for several years now.
But the reason they can sustain is because they don't get just regular freshmen. This is a different spot, man. I mean, this school right here can get the best players from California, can go scoop up some great players across the country in other locations, because USC's a brand. I mean, you got the players in the NFL, you got the success that they've had in the past. I mean, this isn't just a normal school. This is one of the best jobs in the country.
And in a lot of ways, it recruits itself. But the depth is still an issue, and guys in certain positions playing before might be the ideal time, Sam.
Yeah, Reese, it's not just the depth on game day. I was talking to Matt Barkley about this recently, and he said the thing that nobody talks about, the thing that really makes a huge difference is in practice, the guys you're going up against. He said when you don't have those scholarship athletes, you don't get to go best on best as much as you would if you had more guys out there that can help you compete in practice. And we know how much SC's always been about competition in practice.
And Pete Carroll was the head coach, the famous Competition Tuesday. Adoree Jackson's out there. Had a little bump with Nate Gary, or Jackson might have made himself another huge play.
You know what's incredible is Steve Sarkisian's going to focus his recruiting efforts into Southern California and try and build a fits around that. He's not interested in necessarily going national unless you're a special player from outside the state.
Which they'll do. Yeah, they'll get some of those.
And Steve Sarkisian's from Torrance, California. He's got all his relationships from when he coached here and at Washington. He's going to use it.
Justin Davis wrapped up by Malik Collins. What you think about is we turn the page on the probation for USC in the full class coming in February. What some of these guys, the fifth-year seniors, the two most notable or most recognizable guys would be Hayes Pollard and the tight end Randall Telfer, recruited by Pete Carroll, though never played for him, played under Lane Kiffin, fired in the middle of the season. The emotional decision not to give Ed Orgeron the head coaching job on a permanent basis, and now playing for Sark as Kessler loads up on third down and throws it away, and Nebraska gets a much needed stop. But while USC has weathered it pretty well in terms of record on the field, these guys have had a lot of change and a lot of upheaval during their careers, and it's something that the Nebraska players are experiencing right now as well, with the change from Bo Pelini to Barney Cotton tonight and then ultimately to Mike Riley.
Especially when you had such a great run under Pete Carroll.
Mm-hmm. A lot of pressure, and it's blocked. Nebraska's been great on special teams this year, and they block another punt. Let's see who got through and got that one. I believe it was Kyron Williams, who almost got one earlier tonight. They said he did, actually. It saved him from roughing the punter call. And Williams was right back there to get it.
Nebraska overloads it from this side. Just got a lot of free jersey colors coming in on the right side of the screen.
They just didn't get the thing blocked. He's trying to kick it in 2 seconds, but Williams almost intercepted the drop. He's back there in a heartbeat.
Poor punter's taking a beating tonight, hasn't he?
Boy, he has. Alvarado's taking a couple of shots. He's going to be sore. Nebraska blocked a couple of punts against Purdue this year. And special teams efficiency, and there's going to be a penalty on USC for being offside. Special teams efficiency, a measure of how much a team contributes to the final scoring margin, or a unit, I should say. Nebraska's third in the country.
Offside, defense number 22. 5-yard penalty, first down.
It's just a testament also to, again, the effort that Nebraska is playing with tonight on all three facets of the game. Right when it seemed like USC was kind of starting to pull away, Nebraska's answered the bell. You have to give these players and this coaching staff so much credit for the work they put in to tonight, understanding how important this is for these players. And selfishness of the coaching staff and Barney Cotton, their interim head coach right there, they've done an unbelievable job. They should hold their heads high.
Armstrong, the newbie, and a couple of Trojans right on top of him as soon as he made the catch. We've seen resilience from Nebraska. They were down 17 in the last regular season game against Iowa, came back to win that game in overtime. Barney Cotton didn't doubt that his team would play with that same type of heart and resilience, and they certainly have tonight. Here's the few yards away from making this a one-score game. Option. Abdullah. First down for Amir. It'll be first and goal for the Huskers.
And they give you the read option where they've read different guys. Now they give you a different variety with the speed option. Really doing a great job of keeping this USC defense off balance. Just a quarterback, having Armstrong, being able to run the football. You've seen USC this year. Boston College had a lot of success. Quarterback run game is hard to stop once you get multiple guys rolling.
And now Armstrong. Without Abdullah. Nobody set behind Armstrong. High snap, handles it, quarterback run. And Tommy gonna pick up a couple, second and goal.
It's a little different too, a little quarterback power.
But again, it's an example of the volume they have. They've got every quarterback run in the book. And if you're USC, you got 15 practices getting ready for this game. You're watching 12 games of film, and you're seeing so many different types of runs. I mean, what do you prepare for? What do you decide to focus on? That's what makes it so challenging to try to play.
Armstrong just absolutely deked the USC defense by waving as if they were in alignment error. They snapped it to Abdullah, and Leonard Williams was not fooled.
Abdullah obviously doesn't play a lot of quarterback. He hasn't watched a lot of film with 94 in his pass rush. He does not get fooled. He'll shoot the gap right here. Heads up play, swims right around the guard, Mowdy.
Mowdy could have done a little better there and helped him out, too. I mean, Jesse Palmer's not completing that pass, brother.
So now third and goal, and they love to turn that block punt into a touchdown instead of a field goal attempt. Armstrong getting some heat. Tommy pulls it down inside the five, and it'll be stopped just short of the goal line. So now The question is,
no question.
Do you go ahead and go?
Go.
Absolutely,
absolutely,
right?
Defense not getting very many stops. Great job by Armstrong just pulling it down and getting enough where you can make this fun. And now look, they're going to go up tempo.
On the snap, Armstrong wasn't expecting it. Abdullah picked it up, and USC was there. But there is a flag on the field. John Plattenberg made the tackle.
I'm not sure the wide receivers got set.
Slipping and falling, wasn't
it? Yeah, there was a lot of miscommunication. Pearsonella dropped his mouthpiece. He was late getting lined up.
Prior to the snap, false start, offense, number 15.
No
prior
pen.
To the snap, fourth down.
At least that gives him an opportunity now to kick a field goal because the play never happened. What you're seeing didn't occur.
Yeah. What a break. It's not often you say that a penalty is a break for Nebraska, but it is. It'll give them an opportunity to salvage a three spot. Let's take another look at this. You see Pearsonell going to the outside, and Armstrong got a snap and didn't expect it. Abdullah tried to make a little chicken salad and couldn't do it, but the penalty pays off, and now Nebraska's running a player on late. It's a wingman on the left side. Drew Brown's going to try to put through the three-pointer, this one from 24 yards out, and it is perfect. And so the blocked punt by Kyron Williams turns into a field goal for the Cornhuskers. Amir Abdullah, Nebraska, down by 11.
Her phone seems so slow.
You buy DirecTV. If you call yourself a sports fan, you got to get DirecTV. 38-27. Nebraska salvages a field goal after the blocked punt. A couple of mishaps down in the red zone. They get the three out of it. Now the defense needs to come up with a stop. Squib kick, and they'll let it through. And Jackson has it. Jory Jackson has a couple of long touchdown plays tonight. One on a return, one on offense, gets it to the 35. Capital One Bowl Mania continues on Monday. Started with Texas A&M and West Virginia, a couple teams that like to pitch it around the lot. By the way, we send our best out to Clint Trickett, who decided not to play football anymore because of concussions. The West Virginia quarterback have Oklahoma and Clemson at 5:30 in the Russell Athletic Bowl, and then the AmeriCare B100 Texas Bowl. Arkansas and Texas at 9 o'clock Eastern Time will cap off a terrific Monday of bowl action on ESPN. This has been a fun day, too, and what a way to wrap it up with these two storied programs, instantly recognizable uniforms, and they put on a show in San Diego, and Cody Kessler's wanting more, and Juju Smith is out there, and Juju Smith makes a play. Have we mentioned there are a lot of talented freshmen wearing USC uniforms?
It's incredible that a true freshman has the football IQ to not just get on the field, but have the impact that Juju Smith has had this year. Tremendous speed. He's a good route runner. The hands, though, I think, are what make him unique.
Kessler. Touchdown, and it's a freshman, Bryce Dixon. And just like that, the Trojans strike. Boy, Kessler had a little bit of a rough stretch in the first half, and he's gotten a little toasty of late.
There's a coverage bust. You're going to see the tight end expand. This linebacker comes out, 52 runs inside here. There's nobody in the middle of the field off the play action. Take the true freshman tight end. How many times have we said the words true freshman tonight for USC?
Zaire Anderson and Josh Banderas.
Anderson looked hot.
Yes, he did. 45-27, Juju Smith, second team all Pac-12 special teams player, made a big play on offense to set it up. Bryce Dixon finished it off with his fourth touchdown grab of the season. You look at these two programs claimed multiple national championships, USC claiming 11-5, belonging to Nebraska. Heisman winners, 3 for Nebraska, 6, that does not include Reggie Bush, for USC. Number of official bowl appearances, although SC has a couple more that were vacated, and first-round draft picks, there have been a whole bunch of them. USC with 66 first-round draft picks in their storied history.
Amir Abdullah and Demore Houston Allen.
Traveler making his way down here. Trojan rider aboard. And the way USC scoring double figures in every quarter and increasing point totals in every quarter. 10 in the first, 14 in the second, 21 in the third. I have to make sure that horse has some water. And Nebraska was turned away in their last opportunity. And Andy Janovich returns the kickoff, and Nebraska needs to get busy on offense. What about the big cat, Leonard Williams, tonight?
He's been all over the field. He's been a defensive tackle, defensive end. He stood up on the outside. He's shown you the quick spin. He's shown you the power. He's shown you a little bit of everything. This is why he's going to be a top pick in the draft. And Amir Abdullah, just for good measure. Thank God he ducked, because he almost lost his head. Making that last big play to get the goal line stand and make it the field goal.
Well, Williams, there's been an unsportsmanlike conduct penalty apparently called against Nebraska. We actually saw one of those go against Leonard Williams earlier tonight. But Williams in recent days, despite the fact that our draft experts have him right at the top of their draft boards, top five picks, Mel Kiper and Todd McShable having Williams either first or second. We've had some quotes from Leonard recently about the draw of staying at USC, of being a college kid for one more year, playing with his buddies. I mean, it's hard to pass up where he's likely to be in the draft. But, I mean, David, as we watch this play, when a play Abdullah gets a yard, you were in a very similar situation when you were winding up your career at Georgia. What's that experience like?
Well, it's difficult because you do see the end prize of what you've worked for your whole entire life, but I think you also see your friends around you, the guys you came in with, your team with a lot of momentum, and you think championship. And that's what you always play. You always play for to win. And, you know, the rookie salary cap now changes the game, too, because when I was coming out, you're a top 15, top 20 pick. You're guaranteed to sign for at least $7 million, and that changes a little bit now with Leonard Williams. So I think internally you always want to be with your boys and be a kid and experience all there is about college before it becomes business, but you just have to make that decision.
You know, Leonard Williams flexing your shoulders, not just Leonard Williams who will have those types of decisions to make. Terrific defensive lineman from Nebraska, Randy Gregory, also will likely be headed into the draft as Abdullah is wrapped up, and there is Randy. He and his defensive mates been staggered a little bit here with 21 third-round points from USC. There are a couple of guys that, assuming they make the calls that we anticipate, you'll hear their names called very early when the NFL draft rolls around.
Don't think they're not looking at the other one every play, too.
Well, you had a little of that, too, didn't you?
Oh, yeah.
Armstrong scrambling away. Pollard was after him, and he finds Jordan Westerkamp. Westerkamp is running for the end zone. How about that play from Armstrong? And Westerkamp goes 65 yards for the quick strike from Nebraska.
First thing, Armstrong again able to avoid the rush by time, and USC not able to contain him in the pocket. But Jordan Westerkamp, this is textbook job by a receiver coming back to the football here. It's a broken route on a scramble drill, but he comes back to attack the ball and puts on the Jets out in the open field. Tremendous job by Armstrong and a great job by Westerkamp as well.
Westerkamp didn't even bother to catch that one behind his back like he did earlier this year. Westerkamp, the Illinois high school record holder for catches and receiving yards, a sophomore. Been on the receiving end of a game-winning Hail Mary and a behind-the-back catch earlier this year that was all over SportsCenter for an extended period of time and viral on the internet. Now he has himself a 65-yard touchdown in the National University Holiday Bowl.
You know, we talked about how many good NFL prospects there are playing in this game. I think sometimes as a coaching staff, you worry about how devoted those players are to the game plan and to winning the game and not just playing for themselves.
Or taking care of their knees.
Yeah, and statistics and just trying to stay healthy. And I think the one interesting thing about this game is many good prospects that have playing, All these guys are playing hard. Everybody's selling out. Both of these teams have put forth tremendous effort. This has just been an unbelievable holiday. It's been so much fun to watch.
It's sort of in the part of the DNA of the Holiday Bowl over the years to have wild offensive shootouts. This is right in keeping with it. 45-34, still 24 seconds to go in the third quarter. And Juju Smith, who made a big play last time, is going to have to try to make something happen. Smith across the 10, and boy, that's about as good as he could have hoped for with having to chase down the kickoff and pick it up on his one. Gets it out close to the 20. There is a Cornhusker who has not yet gotten to his feet. I believe it might be defensive back Jonathan Rose playing on the kickoff team. The staff attending to him will remind you that Capital One Bowl Mania continues Tuesday on ESPN. It'll start at 3:00 Eastern time. Notre Dame and LSU meet in a bowl game again. Irish trying to stop that four-game losing streak. We saw Leonard Fournette in his last game. A big game against Texas A&M. Georgia and Louisville will play in the Belk Bowl at 6:30 Eastern time. Then the nightcap will be the Foster Farms Bowl. Maryland and Stanford, where a good portion of our crew will be. The three of us will not be there on that night, but all the hardworking men and women who bring you the great pictures and sounds, research, producing, and directing. We'll be there in the Bay Area for that one between the Terrapins and Stanford.
The Belk Bowl between Louisville and Georgia is going to be fun to watch. You got Louisville's third ranked right now run defense in the country. Nick Chubb is a true freshman, was named SEC Offensive Player of the Year at Georgia.
Take a look at what happened to Jonathan Rose. It'll be on the right side of your screen as he comes down to cover the kickoff. The shot he takes.
Yeah.
It was almost like he was.
He lowered his
head. Yeah, had he fallen to his knees a little bit as he took the shot? It looked like it was slipping, maybe.
Ran into Soma Vanuku, the fullback for USC. He's a 270-pound fullback, big body.
I would presume. You don't want to. It's good to see Jonathan's sitting up. I was going to say they had moved him from lying face down to on his back and now sitting up, so certainly that's good news.
People across America are taking advantage of Sprint's Cut Your Bill in Half.
Junior corner Jonathan Rose, who was shaken up on that kickoff coverage team, on his feet. Certainly we're delighted to see that. Leeds, Alabama, began his college career at Auburn before making his way to Lincoln. Leeds, Alabama, hometown of Charles Barkley, too, by the way.
That's terrible.
It's great that Rose is okay. Justin Davis running. Zaire Anderson knocks him down, but a good pickup on first down for SC. There is the spoil of victory. National University Holiday Bowl trophy. There is one quarter left now. USC has an 11-point lead, and Nebraska has 15 minutes to try to pull out its 10th win of the season. Can they get Amir Abdullah going, or that Trojan Express continue to put up big points? Fourth quarter coming from San Diego. The lights shining on San Diego. Boats move through the harbor, and USC starts the fourth quarter of the National University Holiday Bowl with a 45-34 lead. Reese Davis, Jesse Palmer, David Pollack, and Samantha Ponder, glad to have you with us on a beautiful night in San Diego in what has been a highly entertaining game. A lot of subplots, too, for Nebraska. Earlier tonight, we talked with Mike Riley, who will be taking over as the head coach at this game. Barney Cotton leading the Cornhuskers on an interim basis after Bo Pelini was fired. Nebraska going for its 10th win and trying to avoid another four-loss season, something they had in each of Pelini's seasons. But by the same token, only three programs have won nine or more each of the last 7 years. Nebraska's won. Alabama and Oregon are the other two. Adoree Jackson doubles back, and this time He's not going to find any running room. Randy Gregory was waiting on him with some help from Valentine.
You haven't seen very many freshman plays by him, but that was one right there. He's used to being able to outrun everybody in the field. You usually cut back and you make one of those highlight touchdown reels, but had to give that one up. Made a lot of big ones tonight, though, hadn't
he? Yeah, he's been primarily this season a cornerback, but as you guys mentioned earlier, he's been used in spots on offense and they've used him extraordinarily well tonight. Going back to the sideline now, and Kessler going to throw it to Justin Davis out of the backfield, and Justin let it get away, third and 10.
It's a good job by this Nebraska defense now. They're going to force it.
Fourth and 10, yeah, I apologize.
They're going to set up a punting situation, get the football back in good field position, and down only 11 points. There's a lot of football to go here. Just under 15 minutes left. Nebraska continues to fight. The defense coming up with a big stop at a key time.
You know, last time Nebraska had it, Armstrong found Jordan Westerkamp for 65 yards. Now a high punt. Pearson L.
Fair catch,
something he does not like to do, but he does inside his own 45. A 38-yard punt with no return. And here is Adoree Jackson's ninth. Started after a Nebraska field goal taking the kickoff to the house.
Yeah, playing three ways this year wasn't an experiment for Steve Sarkisian, this coaching staff. This is going to be something that Adoree Jackson continues to do. Open the game up with a kickoff return score. They fed him the football out of the backfield on a long catch and run. A lot of talented true freshmen for USC, but this number two, he might be the most talented of them all.
And here's a senior who's pretty talented in his own right, Amir Abdullah, wrapped up by Hayes Pillard. Here are the impact freshmen tonight. Jackson, Juju Smith, who had a big night as well, and Bryce Dixon scored a touchdown.
Yeah, I mean, those are three guys that you can build around. All three making explosive plays. And you think even Dixon, the guy we haven't talked about that much, you saw him blocking as well, which is a great sign, having an athletic tight end that can block and scary bright future for USC.
And speaking of scary bright future, that guy's got one, DeMorne Pearson-L, another freshman who's had a terrific night.
And when Tommy Armstrong has had a clean pocket, he's been the most accurate when he's throwing down the field. That time again, the offensive line, their short two starters, does a nice job giving him vision to locate Pearson-L on the smash route.
And Pearson L's over 100 yards receiving. Pretty good belated birthday present. Celebrated his birthday yesterday. Amir Abdullah spinning inside the 35 into the 33.
The thing I like about Abdullah is that he's a disciplined runner. He's a very good inside runner for a guy that's just 5'9", 200 pounds. There's a lot of backs in the crew. If they had his speed, they would bounce everything outside, but he puts his nose in there. He gets the tough 2-, 3-, and 4-yard gains that you need.
Now they've got a screen set up for him on the outside, but a good open field tackle from Adoree Jackson.
He's efficient. He never wastes steps. He's got good vision. And you talk about 197, but he doesn't get, you don't see him get rocked. He's put together pretty well. Had a heck of a season. If Armstrong throws the pill well, remember, he's running against stacked boxes for most of the season. He's had a great, great season.
David, too, despite his size, he's one of only three backs to have more than 700 yards, both inside and outside the tackles. The other two, Melvin Gordon and James Conner of Pitt. One of the reasons that Tim Becker was his lead recruiter, getting him out of Homewood, Alabama, is Nebraska's going to have to burn a timeout to play clock on top of them. And Tim Beck said that when he was recruiting Amir Abdullah, that one of the things that impressed him, despite the size, was how tough he ran inside. And he's been tough all night. He was taking a break on the previous play as the Huskers used a timeout down 11.
Philanthropy begins with a cause, grows with a gift, then transforms communities. National University San
100-yard receiving game, and Nebraska's trying to make it a one-possession game inside the 35 of SC. Give on the inside, and Abdullah is stopped by Hutchins.
Another zone read.
Pelham was ready.
They're reading Pallone, yeah, number nine, right up top here. It's the guy they're going to read. They're going to leave him unblocked. That's the give inside to Abdullah. Right. Sitting up fourth and short.
Fourth down. And again, we saw this earlier, snap problems and a false start. And again, maybe the false start is going to keep Nebraska from having disastrous situation on fourth down, and Barney Cotton is irate.
False start. Offense, number 68. 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
That's Barney's son, Jake, who's called for the false start.
68 right here.
Trying to get a good jump off the ball, but he moved early. I mean, it's pretty simple call.
Now, fourth and six from the 34. Huskers are going to go for it. Armstrong's had a career night. Needs to keep this drive alive. Armstrong got company in the backfield, gets away from Pallone. Armstrong throws it, but now did it. Kind of spot is he going to get? He completed it to Bell, and they're spotting him short of the first down.
It was a great job by Armstrong buying time, using the ref actually as a shield too when he rolled around. But I think Bell caught that ball with his knees on the ground in front of the first down marker.
What a tough break.
Watch him use the ref as a shield right here when he rolls out right there.
You see J.R. Tavai just throw left guard Jake Cotton on the floor to try and get pressure on Armstrong, and there you go.
Knees down,
and the football's the football's way out in front of the first down marker.
And Bell, the veteran receiver, was right at the stick, but needed a little more wiggle room. When we came back to the ball, it wouldn't come up short of the first down, and costly failure to convert for Nebraska, and USC has it back with 11 and a half to go in the ball game, up by 11.
They made so many big plays in the passing game. You wonder if they take the foot off the accelerator here and just try to grind out the clock, or they stay aggressive. They've had so much success, it'd be hard to dial it back.
Not much running room for Allen that time, so third down and long coming.
Well, David, I think the success they've had throwing it has come off of their ability of running the football from the second quarter on. And they've done a good job dialing up play action on first down, taking advantage of a defense maybe that was expecting run. Now this is a little bit different now. They're in a third and long situation. And we mentioned earlier, this defensive line, they've got to dominate in the second half. Pass rush. You need it here, whether it's Gregory number four, Collins number seven, someone's got to win.
Husker's trying to force a three and out. Aguilar has the catch, and he's knocked down right at the yard line he needed. And it looks as if, from where the officials coming across, that they're going to spot him short of the yellow line, which, as a reminder, is unofficial. And the officials are signaling fourth down.
Look at the catch with his hands. A high ball goes up and plucks it. Then he lands on top of the defender for a second. And then goes down. Here's a better angle here. Right there. Looks like it would be short by a little bit, because the ball was in his right hand coming back. But
and Sarkisian's
going to
send his punting unit on for the moment, but Richard Jordan in the replay booth is going to have another look. I think one of the things to look is to see exactly when Aguilar hit the ground, because he could have landed on top of Byers and Cockrell for a moment and then bounced across. And
there, his hip
was down, and it appears the ball is short. Whether they have enough video evidence to change, we'll see right after the break.
Rated R.
Replay booth letting this spot stand on the third down play, meaning the Trojans will face fourth down. Dave Kataya, our rules expert here, as you take another look from the angle at which his hip goes down. What'd you think of the call, Dave?
I think it's a pretty good spot. The hip is on the player, but watch here. Now the hip gets right there. The ball is dead. And the play's going to stand because there's no angle down the line. But from that angle, it does look short.
Looked like a really, really good spot on the field, too. Which
I would agree.
Seems to me, among the many difficult things of officiating, that's got to be chief on the list sometimes in terms of third down plays where an inch or two can make a difference. And Nebraska desperately needed that stop. So with 9:43 left, they've got the ball back down by 11. New Year's 6, big bowl games kick off New Year's Eve. This part of the games set up by the College Football Playoff Selection Committee. We'll start with the Chick-fil-A Peach Bowl, Ole Miss and TCU, a battle of top 10 teams. Boise State and Arizona in the Vizio Fiesta Bowl at 4 o'clock Eastern Time. And then the Capital One Orange Bowl, Mississippi State and Georgia Tech at 8 o'clock Eastern Time. You'll be ringing in the new year with that one.
There are worse places to be in the world on New Year's Eve than South Beach, my friends.
Palmer and Latte.
Jesse and Brett Musburger letting ring in the new year with some college football. It is one of the, we've used this phrase a lot, as the College Football Playoff Selection Committee did when this system was put into place. Traditionally, New Year's Eve and New Year's Day have been dominated by college football, and really, while the BCS, I think, was unfairly maligned in many cases, that is one thing that was lost a little bit. It's the significance of the big bowl games on those days as Sue Cravens knocks down the pass attempt from Tommy Armstrong. And with the New Year's Six games and then the college football playoff games and
appointment television.
Rose Bowl and Super Bowl. Television.
I mean, just sit on the couch, get a comfy couch, comfy chair, a big fat screen TV. If you don't finance one, you'll be fine.
And get weird.
Third down and five. Nebraska trying to keep this drive alive. With a little game pressure on USC. Got a middle screen set up for Abdullah. Amir Abdullah has the first down and a bunch more. Amir Abdullah's off to the races and finally tracked down at the 40-yard line. A perfect play call from Tim.
And it's a really good job by the quarterback, Tommy Armstrong, negotiating a defender and find the lane and an arm angle to make the throw. And oftentimes, Dean Adam has got to fit the football in between defenders and into the hands of number eight. And again, Amir Abdullah showing you why. He's a different player when he's healthy.
Only 65 yards on the ground, but 54 more pass receptions. 33 coming on that play, and the Huskers move it inside the 40 of USC. Armstrong, good catch by his tight end, Seathan Carter.
Seathan Carter's a good athlete. He's a guy, only a sophomore. He's got a lot of good years ahead of him under Mike Riley as a head coach. You're right, Reese. That was not a good throw. Thrown behind him, and he plucks it out of the air. Cornhuskers again, Big Red on the march.
And go quickly, Newby. Has the first down. Newby continues to keep those legs churning inside the 25-yard line.
Running like he's motivated because he's from L.A. That's where he grew up and played his high school football. There's a couple players in Nebraska from the Los Angeles area. Very, very motivated to go in this game.
Six Californians wearing the white of Nebraska tonight. Westerkamp, who has a touchdown, looking for the corner inside the 20 and pushed out of bounds by Josh Shaw.
This is the fastest tempo I think that we've seen Nebraska run on offense so far here late in the game. You know, USC does not sub a lot on defense, and already these players on D, they've played already 79 snaps.
Back to Newby. It's going to be about a yard or so short of the first down there.
Played 79 snaps. Have had a rough time finishing this football season. This is the point in games they've had struggles. They've given up a lot of points. They got to bow up, get the ball back to their offense, and not blow a lead.
Newby hit in the backfield by Williams. Coming off that edge like a big cat.
Well, Givens Price, the right tackle, has to give a better effort than this. And the last two plays, we see the exact same thing. Watch 78. You got one hand patty cake's not going to work against the top five pick. You got to anticipate an inside slant, get your head out in front. And how big is this down right now for Nebraska?
You don't kick this to go get down within one possession?
I would.
It's a good point. You make it an 8-point game. You need the field goal at some point anyway, unless you can get a couple of touchdowns, and it's a very long one they have to get. But then again, they said they were going to take some chances. Armstrong makes it pay off. Armstrong headed for the end zone. Did he get in? Touchdown, Nebraska. How about this run from Tommy Armstrong Jr.? Nine-play, 77-yard drive. So rather than kick that field goal, which would have been a sound strategic play, now they'll go for two to get within a field goal of USC.
Really impressed with Barney Cotton and Tim Beck and the game plan offensively they've had today, because this is a very good USC defense.
Barney Cotton wanted his team to use his words to honor God, to honor their teammates, to show their loyalty to Bo Pelini, and to show their character one more time together. And boy, are the Huskers doing that. With inside 7 minutes to go, they get this two, and they're within a field goal. Abdullah resets, and Armstrong firing to the outside. There's Bell, and there's a deuce, and we've got a field goal game with 6:52 remaining in San Diego.
We saw Kenny Bell score a touchdown early in the game on the exact same route. As we go back to the option that scored with Tommy Armstrong, we talked about how his legs are going to have to be a factor in this game. Gamble for it on fourth down. It's the speed option. He does a really good job pressing against Scott Felix. How about Kenny Bell, the wide receiver number 8, downfield, getting a tremendous block, bringing the quarterback in for the score.
Might have got away with a little hold right there. Leonard Williams trying to make a play, but Armstrong doing it with his legs and then the two-point conversion. Did it with his arms. No turn off the television yet. Yeah, game.
Oklahoma Holiday Bowl is brought to you by National University. Keep learning at nu.edu. Buick. Experience the new Buick during the Buick Holiday Sales Event. And Sprint.
That's a dangerous corner down there for our buddy Wade Hewitt on the handheld camera. Wade said that his camera was broken earlier, but it's good. He's giving us some great pictures. He and Andre Koroskeny down there, field level, not too proud to stick their face in the fan. Those big players come hurtling toward him. And boy, I tell you what, Nebraska has fought. USC's been terrific as well. And there goes another kick return, this time from Juju Smith. And 45-42. And Samantha's down on the Nebraska sideline.
Yeah, for obvious reasons, Reese, all smiles from Barney Cotton there, coming up to his bench, very confident, telling them, you're going to win this game because of the way you've acted over the past 3 weeks. So proud of this team. But also, David, what you said about the USC D-line getting tired, he told his O-line the same thing. He said, they're tired, just finish it.
They'll have an opportunity. They need a little help from their defense. They get some, a little pressure on Kessler. Cody unloads it, throws it into double coverage, incomplete. It'll be second and 10. You know, I was talking to Barney Cotton yesterday, former Nebraska player, and he's been through this a couple of times at Nebraska. He was on Frank Solich's staff when he was dismissed after a 9-win season. Now it happened with Bo Pelini again, and I asked him how it impacted his feelings or affected his feelings toward his alma mater. And I thought he had a great response. He said, I don't want to hate Nebraska. It means too much to me. You see how much it means by the way he's been able to pull this group together and the hurt feelings and the anger that the players felt and the coaches for that matter. And Mike Riley coming in a very difficult situation to observe and try to get his tenure started. Mike's one of the all-time great guys taking over for Nebraska, but it's been tough on the coaching staff behind and tough on the players, and they have acquitted themselves beautifully here in San Diego. Right now, they'd like to get off the field on third down with the defense. Cody Kessler, pocket closing, down he goes. Cody Kessler sacked, and the Huskers are going to get it back.
The defensive line owned the last three plays for the Nebraska Cornhuskers against the run and with the pass rush. We saw Vincent Valentine on the first down force Cody Kessler to step up and throw an incomplete pass. This time, they're gonna loop inside with number 4, Gregory. It's just too much push, everybody staying in their lane. Great gap integrity, and now again, Nebraska getting the football back, and momentum shifted back in their corner.
Where were you gonna throw that football? There wasn't a dang thing open. Great coverage in the back end, too.
Remember, Nebraska got a punt earlier tonight. Alvarado gets this one out of there. Not a lot of pressure coming from the Cornhuskers that time as USC has its third straight three and out. And perhaps it's the depth that's caused USC to fade late against Arizona State. Berkovici let one go. The Hail Mary that Jalen Strong just caught, final play of the game, gave the Sun Devils the victory. Utah against USC. Kalen Clay making the grab, holding on to it for the game-winning touchdown, 24-21. Close losses. They had a close win against Arizona as well. But SC's had a couple of opportunities. The Arizona State game particularly should have been won by the Trojans.
You can't help but wonder what if, right? Sure. You lose three games by 13 points, two in the final play. A lot of fans want it.
Westerkamp has an alley. He has the first down. And Nebraska has had the momentum wrestled away from them on a couple of occasions tonight. Been able to fight back and regain the momentum with big plays. Westerkamp made one of them, and he gets a first down now as we head toward 5 minutes to play. Abdullah on the corner. Oh, Amir. Couple of plays, couple of first downs for the Huskers.
Nice job pulling in Nebraska. The right guard, Mowdy, 74, gets out in front. Watch him seal the edge. It's a little shoulder on Leonard Williams. There's Abdullah, just looking limber, nimble.
High snap, Armstrong handles it to the outside. Riley is dragged down. A good pickup on first down, be second and short.
And USC's not an aggressive defense. They blitz, you know, really second lowest amount for college football for the season. But they're gonna have to do something. These little dinks and dunks and the running game kill them. They're gonna have to get more aggressive and bring more bodies near the line of scrimmage.
Back to Abdullah. Cut! But inside the 40, Pollard got him, or Amir might have been running for a while.
But you talk about, too, the tempo and the depth. When you're spitting on the perimeter, defensive linemen have to run to the football. When you're running on the perimeter, defensive linemen have to run. And your tempo and this depth and this lack of depth on the D-line, they're trying to sub, get fresh bodies in there, but you're just doing a great job of wearing them down.
See, this is good. Nebraska now slowing the tempo down now. They understand about 4 minutes left to go, how big this drive is. You want to have the perfect play call on each and every snap. These are all precious.
Armstrong. Oh, just about got loose. He'll be knocked down. J.R. Tavai made the tackle.
The shotgun quarterback exchange with the center has been an issue. But you see, even here, Armstrong kind of, you know, mishandles the snap. And these are things certainly you wouldn't expect to be an issue in the bowl game. And obviously, you've got a third string center, but, you know, that snap was okay. That's one that Armstrong has got to handle clean.
It's a good play by Tavai to hustle out there and make that tackle.
Abdullah running tough, gets down to the 31. He'll be about 3 yards short of the first down.
And that's what he does, man. He just continues to, he's not one of those littler backs that you can't feed him the rock 20 times. You can count on the run between those tackles and be durable, especially when you've already given the body blows to USC throughout this game. Leonard Williams just came off the field on that last drive, too, or that last play, too.
If you're Nebraska, you can't afford a loss of yardage here. You're just on the cusp of field goal range, down three. You got to be smart.
And the timeout is called as the play clock was about to expire. So a third down and three coming. This would be a reach for the field goal kicker, Drew Brown. Barney Cotton would much prefer getting those 3 yards. That is Nebraska kicker Drew Brown, freshman whose career long is 44 yards, hit from 50 in warmups. He's a younger brother of former Husker kicker Chris Brown. But Nebraska instead would like to keep his offensive drive going. Precisely 1,000 yards combined of offense for Nebraska and USC tonight. A 45-42 lead for the Trojans with 2:39 to play. Third down. Armstrong over the middle, incomplete, intended for Pearsonell. It'll be fourth down coming. Leon McQuay was on the coverage.
Great coverage by McQuay. Clean, does a nice job avoiding the contact with the wall. You're going to see him right up top here. It comes down. Oh, just gets that left hand out to bat the football away.
It's a heck of a job because you know that's a run situation all the way. Nebraska's run the football so many times.
And they're not going to give Brown the shot on the long field goal. Feel more comfortable with the offense. Little flip to Pearsonell, and Pearsonell struggling but hit. What a tremendous play again by McQuay. The last two plays made by the sophomore Leon McQuay. And Nebraska will have to turn it over on downs, and they only have one timeout left.
Two big-time plays back-to-back. When their defense needed to make a stand, McQuay's all the way at the right side of your screen over here. Now watch when he goes in motion. Knows he's going to give the football. It's a forward pass. And look at him turn on the jets. Run full speed. You had to go full speed. It's fourth and short. And make the great ankle tackle.
You know, it's great to see him make that play. He really struggled in their loss against UCLA late in the season. Didn't play very many snaps against Notre Dame. But tonight, critical down and distance. Here's the third down play. Breaks up the pass. And then the biggest play on the fourth down makes the tackle. Tremendous job.
USC goes to the ground. Buck Allen. Allen has a first down.
Remember, Nebraska only has one timeout left. You've got to be very smart when they decide to use that. USC on offense, they're going to slow this tempo way down, try and bleed this game clock as much as they can. Two backs in the backfield. We talked about how those types of sets have given this defense issues in the running game this season.
That would have been a really long field goal attempt for Brown. You think Barney Cotton made the right call to go ahead
and
try to?
Yeah, I do.
My question would be this. If you weren't comfortable with the field goal, I think the third down play might have been when I would have run it. I knew I'm going for it on fourth anyway. But as it stands, Huskers down three, need to get the ball back. Only one timeout left. Dave, what did you think? Would you have tried to kick it, or how would you manage?
Well, I think the third down play, you can afford to do that if you're going for the win. I don't think there's anything to lose, Reese. You know, I mean, this is a team that, you know, everybody's out the door. Every player you're trying to win for all these players that have been through a rough time. I think I'm okay with it. I mean, you could have kicked the field goal. You could argue it's a bowl game. It doesn't mean that much. Go for the win. Try to help the players get a win.
I think we've all been very impressed watching the effort of Nebraska.
No doubt.
We talked all game long about, you know, their motivation in this game and just how well they've responded. I think you have to give USC credit as well, though. They've played hard. You know, they're trying to capitalize on momentum they just gained from a big win, an impressive win against a rival in Notre Dame, and carry that into next season. And they understand how winning a bowl game like this can impact your recruiting class. And we've talked about how the NCAA sanctions lifted, as you see Barney Cotton there giving Amir Abdullah a hug. I think USC also understands that what a win in tonight's game, kind of the impact that can have on their first recruiting class they haven't had in a long time, what they'll have next year.
Especially finishing. This is a tape that Sark shows in the offseason and says, this is what we have to do next season. We played great against everybody we played against except for UCLA, and we didn't finish ball games. This is what it looks like, and this is what we need to do in the future.
USC,
because it's over either, by the way.
No, it's
we've seen a Hail Mary from...
Yeah. He's our last game on the last Thursday night of the season.
And then it's Arizona State.
Yeah.
Sark's seen that one before, too.
We have the questionable clock management by East Carolina, we believe, to be the first time in college football history a team ever went into victory formation and lost.
Can't find anybody to dispute it yet.
So what do you do here for USC? Third and three. Nebraska doesn't have any more timeouts.
You pound the rock.
Yeah, I think you can go straight north.
Now, they haven't converted a third down this half, 0 for 5. And they still have it. It'll be fourth down. The 40-second play clock is going to be about, what, a 23-second differential. So you let this run all the way down, and there'll be 23 seconds left.
And take a delay game and get all the seconds off, back it up. No,
well,
back it
call,
up,
you call
but you get the extra 5 yards.
Well,
or call a timeout. Either
yeah.
one.
Okay, well, they have a quick kick thing they do on fourth and short in these types of situations with their quarterback, Cody Kessler. So that's live. They've already had a punt blocked in this game. And DeMornay Pearsonell has already taken 3 punts to the house.
So there's
some issues right now if you're USC.
Is Kessler going to punt it? Well, there's a false start on the left side by Lobendon.
I think it might be offsides.
It was. False start.
False start's on offense, though.
Yeah, false.
I thought it was offsides on D. Nebraska's
defense.
Well, there were players on defense for Nebraska reacting. They looked pretty upset.
False start. Okay. Offense number 50. It'll be a 5-yard penalty. There will be no 10-second runoff.
I thought it was interesting what they did there, Reese. Because I think Kessler was going to punt it.
Right.
And if you do that, there's nobody back deep. You can let more time tick off the clock. But now
they flat out blocked one, as you guys mentioned. They were ruled to have deflected another one, but they were there to block it. And that was early in the game. So they've gotten heat on the punters. You understand why Sark wouldn't go full punt. Kessler's punted it 7 times in his career out of that short punt formation. And you heard the referee Randy Crystal talk about there would be no 10-second runoff. The defense, in this case Nebraska, would have the opportunity, and they so chosen by rule, to run off the 10 seconds. Obviously they don't want to. That's a rule put into place to stop teams from stopping the clock by committing infractions. That was why he said that, if you happen to be wondering. Just a little tidiness, a little house cleaning. So now the other thing too is you want to save every second you can, and as USC is now sending its punt team out, Chris Alvarado, first of all, you want to make sure you don't get the thing blocked, but secondly, if you can field it as quickly as possible and not let it roll and not let the seconds tick away on 26 seconds remaining in the game, Nebraska, you got to believe, is going to bring the house. Riley, bottom of the screen's fast, and Alvarado gets it out of there quickly, and Pearsonell catches it on the fly. He's taken 3 all the way back. We won't get a chance this time, so there will be. And there's a flag coming in. They're going to get 15 extra yards. Tech is Soma Vanuku. They're going to draw that penalty.
Soma Vanuku is a guy that's been a bit of a special teams demon throughout his career. He had 3 block punts last year for this team. You saw him have a big block earlier
in
this game on a kick return. He is, but he's got to have better judgment than this right here. You see number 31.
After the play, personal foul, number 31. We have a 15-yard penalty, first down.
That is just not smart.
Dumb.
Now, this is more time than the game we referenced earlier, the last Thursday night game of the season between East Carolina and UCF. This is more time than UCF had, and not too far the difference in terms of field position.
And you only need a field goal.
Yeah, they can get close enough for a field goal. Trojans are back in prevent.
Talked about Hail Marys. Remember Nebraska last year beating Northwestern. It wasn't Tommy Armstrong. It was Ryan Kellogg.
But it was Jordan Westerkamp.
But it was Jordan Westerkamp. So just heads up.
Can't take a sack. Yeah. You have to work the edge of the field.
Now, Hail Mary's not coming yet now. It would be a false start. And in this case, by the way, it won't be a 10-second
false start.
Runoff.
The clock offense, number 74. 5-yard penalty, first down.
Exactly, David, because you get the 10-second runoff if there is a penalty that causes the clock to stop. This one did not. With 17 seconds left, it just means they're back 5 yards.
Better block 94 right here in the middle. He's been bull rushing and using quick little swim moves all game.
That's a third string center he's going against again.
Last gasp effort. Huskers trying to avoid their 4th loss. Trying to do so with a miracle. Armstrong incomplete. 13 seconds.
The pass is incomplete. Intended for number 87, Brendan Rundley.
They got to hit one of those. You got to hit something a little bit short right here.
If you hit one of those short passes beyond the first down marker, the game clock will stop. You can rush up to the line of scrimmage and spike it. Give yourself an opportunity.
USC is going to play deep.
Yeah.
They're going to keep everything in front of them, so they're going to give you that little short pass for 10 yards.
Catch it and head to the boundary. Abdullah. Amir steps out of bounds. 8 seconds left.
I wouldn't have done that short.
He could throw it behind the sticks.
But Tommy Armstrong's got a big-time arm. So, you know, you don't necessarily need to get to the 50 for him to reach the end zone on a Hail Mary. But right now, I mean, this has to be a kind of a bang-bang play out of bounds to stop the clock. Give yourself an opportunity.
Armstrong. Well, this is a tough one. They're going to go ahead and try the lateral. Kenny Bell, can he get out of bounds in time? Does he have a second left? Let's see if time expired. The officials are going to talk it over and see if... And... Randy Crystal is signaling.
The previous play is under review.
I remember last year in the Iron Bowl, the Alabama-Auburn game, they reviewed this and put a second on the clock, and we know how that one ended. Let's see if there's a second left here as he tried a little hook and lateral, and Kenny Bell got out of bounds. Did he do it in time?
He didn't have a lot of sense of urgency getting out of bounds.
Should be one.
Yeah, there should be one, though.
Dave Kataya, are we going to have a second left for one more play?
Well, it sure looks like it here. Let's see this thing roll forward and see what we got. All right, he's out of bounds right now. He's down. Clock shows one. I think they're going to put it on.
Hey, Nebraska, Texas. Remember that one?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Several years ago.
Yeah. That was one. Colt McCoy threw the ball away.
Out of bounds.
For those who don't remember, and was very fortunate that the ball hit something to cause the clock to stop with a second. Texas kicked a field goal, won the Big 12 championship game. That's when Nebraska was in the Big 12, and Texas went on to the national championship game.
So if there is a second to go and they get one more play, if you're USC defensively, you got to be anticipating. You take a look back at this again, Kenny Bell. You look to just kind of see him sprinting right now,
like
dive out of
out.
Bounds. Like it looks like he's trying to break the tackle and get north more.
Yeah.
But there's definitely looks to be a second left on the game clock. What I was saying earlier, if there is one more play now, as a defense, you have to anticipate Tommy Armstrong getting outside. You got to cut those pass rush lanes off. And I love their idea, having their best player, Leonard Williams, playing right up the middle.
Well, how about you also make sure you bat the ball down?
Yeah.
We've seen this movie before. You've seen how it ends for...
And I want you to notice right now...
After further review, there's 1 second left in the ball game.
I want you to notice right now that Hayes Pollard, who tried to field that Hail Mary from Arizona State like a punt, right, on
it's
the goal
not
line.
Deep.
Jalen Strong cut in front of him. Hey, Hayes, who's a terrific player, by the way, but they've got him in his comfort zone now. He's up around the 50-yard line.
But it's smart because they got Aguilar, I think, and Juju Smith deep, who are receivers who understand how to play the ball in the air a little bit better. So if you, but you still want them to knock it down, Reese.
Yeah.
Don't go up and try to catch a football like you're on offense. Knock the ball to the ground.
Tommy Armstrong's going to have to unleash it with everything he's got. Final play of the game. Armstrong buying some time, loads it up, throws it just as far as he can. I'm going to tell you, Brandon Riley is being held back there. Don't see a flag. Aguilar knocks it out of bounds, and USC wins the Holiday Bowl. ...45-42, the final in a thrilling game. And Steve Sarkisian gets a bowl victory. By the way, Sarkisian gets just his second bowl victory, both of them, over Nebraska in the National University Holiday Bowl. Had one when he was the head coach at Washington as well. Here's the final play, and
Nelson Aguilar.
That's 13,
yeah.
I believe.
No, I think it was 15.
Knocked it down.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the penalty.
Oh, sure.
There by Kevon Seymour, who had a double handful of Brandon Riley.
It's not a penalty unless it's called, but look at Aguilar.
Okay.
Aguilar didn't let anything come down. He was like, forget that. I'm going to volleyball spike this into the ground.
Our Capital One player of the game is USC's Adoree Jackson, who had a 98-yard kickoff return for a touchdown, caught three passes for 73 yards and a score, and was terrific at his normal position at cornerback. And the end of a great career for Amir Abdullah, and the dawning of a new era of Nebraska football with Mike Riley taking over after Barney Cotton led the Huskers on an interim basis. Final score from San Diego, 45-42, USC beats Nebraska. Join us on ESPN3 for the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One. SportsCenter is coming up in precisely 15 seconds.